You want a piece of me, boy?
Nuclear launch detected.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Nation Wars 4. We just seen Ukraine demolish the United States of America. How does it feel?
Feels bad, man.
Feels bad, man.
Feels bad.
No, that was an interesting result, I guess. Like, nobody expected that. We all predicted USA to win this match.
Yes, we did.
And in the end, Neeb just not performing at his own level. Nate was actually kind of close. Like, I mean, he made it close for a moment.
I love
burning a lot of drones, but
yeah, DeMuslim actually made a tweet that the closest game in that series was Nate versus Blind. Just throwing it out there. So, but yeah, that was such a surprise. It's not even that like Neeb was playing, like, to say that he was playing bad doesn't quite explain it. He just was playing like, well, do you know who you're facing?
Exactly.
Like,
exactly.
It was so weird.
Taking unnecessary risk against Bly.
Exactly.
Like, I mean, everybody knows. Like, when you install StarCraft, I think one of the messages is actually never trust Bly. And, you know, make a mothership core, make a wall against Bly. That's the kind of stuff that Bly throws at you. But that's an all kill for Bly, and that's actually super nice for him. So kudos to him, obviously. Our next match is going to be Australia. And see, I know my flags now.
Oh, good.
And
good job.
I believe this is Norway.
I think so.
So that's our second game, and we will know we'll be facing Ukraine in the winners' match.
Sorry,
after this one, we will know
we'll be facing Ukraine. We'll be facing Ukraine in the winners' match. I mean, I think everyone's giving it to Snoots, I suppose, but we did just witness the leader of America, Neeb, not do so hot either. And I mean, Australia does have this strong lineup. Aegis is someone that has always had this potential to show like super good results. Probe is someone that everyone actually highly respects and thinks can do very well. And then Seether, I don't know much about Seether, to be honest, or Scyther. I think we're going to go with Seether.
Seether is just fine.
Sure, okay, that's what we're going to go with. Don't know much about him, but I've actually been hearing that he's actually pretty strong as well.
All right. Well, we'll see exactly how strong he is, because we will have an interview in just a couple of seconds. So, guys, take it away for the interview between Australia and Norway.
Thank you so much, Funka. Thank you so much, ZombieGraph. I am joined by the one and only... I heard he called you TTL. I'm not buying it. It's the King of Lies.
All right. Then just for you, it's the King of Lies, but it's usually TKL.
I like the King of Lies a lot.
All right.
Sounds better. Man, what do you think about that first game, Ukraine-USA?
Well, you got blind counted, basically.
So not blind counted, but blind counted?
Yeah. And the Ukrainian Zerg is very strong, and I can't wait to see more games of him.
I believe I'm getting a new microphone. I'm just going to get both. Can I hold them both?
All right. So maybe my first one didn't work. Doesn't matter. I made some bad jokes anyway.
All right.
Yeah.
It happens. It happens.
So let's see if our team captains are ready. I assume it's going to be Aegis for Australia. And then I also assume it's going to be...
Snoot for Norway.
Yeah.
Should be. All right. Hello, guys. How are you?
G'day.
Hello. I'm good. Thanks.
Oh, Jens, looking fly as always. I guess. Okay, I mean, you're also looking very good. Love the glasses in particular. Let's talk with Jens first. Jens, you guys played yesterday, right?
Yeah.
You went up against New Zealand, if I recall correctly. It was kind of close. Went it the way that you expected, or did you think it got a little scary, perhaps?
No, I mean, we sent out Scythe first, and he took out Crimson, but then lost to Mighty Kiwi. I think maybe we could have done a little bit better. I think Scythe definitely could have taken some more maps, but he got kind of cheesed out, I think. Evir took a map as well, so, you know, I think it went okay. We ended at 4-2, and it's not too bad, I think.
Well, your game was kind of close,
it's acceptable.
Your game on Echo was kind of close, wasn't it?
Yeah, I agree. I'm a bit disappointed.
And on the other hand, we have Aegis for Australia. The French people know you quite well, Aegis, for flipping the fingers to the cameras. I have a question. Should we know the other players of Australia to be flipping fingers as well?
Nah, they're polite boys. They are. They wouldn't dare do anything so rude and uncouth.
All right. And how do you think the match will go against Norway?
Yeah, pretty well. We already took out one group of Euros. We're looking forward to take out another one. Maybe even more. Take them all out.
All right.
Do you feel a brotherhood with New Zealand as well? And do you feel like you have to avenge them?
I mean, a fraternal bond with New Zealand, sure. But one might, one would do well to remember that Cain and Abel were also brothers.
What the fuck?
All right. So I have no idea where this is going to go. Jens, what do you think about this match? What do you think about the group overall? Let's start with this group overall first. And then what do you think about your matchup against Australia?
I think this is probably the best group that Norway could have gotten. I think the other groups are a lot harder. I'm very happy to dodge some of the stronger nations like Korea and Poland.
Netherlands.
Yeah, yeah.
Or France.
So I think this is probably the best group, and the level is very similar, I think, between all the four different countries. So I think it's a very exciting group. Anything can happen. And I think if we do advance from this match, then it's very likely that we can advance in first place. So I hope we can win this one. And
yeah.
Then I think
would you say that the group has been turned upside down a little bit? Because I think a lot of people looked at it as maybe a clash between you and Neep, but maybe in the end you guys are good enough to carry that it's going to be USA and Norway anyway. Do you feel things are very different now with Ukraine advancing in the winners match?
A little bit, maybe. It's going to be dangerous for USA, for example. Let's say if Norway loses to Australia now, then maybe things might get scary for USA in the lower bracket. So I think it's definitely scary for the US right now. I wouldn't like to be in their position, for sure. But Bly delivered, so that's what we need to work with, I guess.
I guess, would you say that this match right now is even more important than it already was? Because maybe facing Ukraine looks more tempting on paper than going up against Neep?
I don't know. They're both, like, pretty decent lineups. On one hand, Ukraine's a lot more well-rounded. Like, those three players are all, you know, they're all pretty decent.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, going up against two Neebs. It's not my idea of a quality Christmas weekend.
All right.
Well, Merry Christmas, two Neebs.
Merry Christmas, two Neebs, indeed. And so let's admit that Australia wins this match against Norway. What would be your ideal opponent in the winners' match? I'd rather lose. Who would you rather meet in the deciding match if you were to lose?
I really don't know. I don't think I could give you a real proper answer.
They're not thinking. They're only thinking about victory. That's
all
what
right.
It is.
That's why
they're not thinking about any lower bracket shenanigans over here. All right, so I think we've chitty-chatted long enough. I would like to hear the first player. Snoot, go first. Who's going to represent Norway?
Yeah, so Scythe did a great job yesterday, but he couldn't be here today because of traveling and family and stuff. So we're actually bringing in our replacement for the first map, so that's going to be Solo.
Ah, young Solo. All right. It's pretty strong, Zerg. I've seen him a lot in the past.
Yeah, and for Australia, who's going to be the first player, Jaegers?
We're going to send out Probe.
All right.
Okay. So last but not least, this is kind of a Nation Wars tradition, and this is where things get interesting. Snoot, prediction for the match?
I'm going to go with 4-2, I think, same as yesterday.
For Norway?
Yeah, I'm going to be nice.
All right. Igus?
4-3 victory to us. We're going to keep things nice and dramatic.
Well, expect a lot of upsets then, and we're going to throw it back to the casters. Please, Funka and Zombie Grub, take it away.
That was a superb, superb throw. Thank you. Thank you so much, TKL. So we heard it. Norway is not going to be able to send the exact same team. So they will have their replacement player, Solo, who's a Zerg player, going out against Probe. So ZVP to start things off.
Yep, ZVP. I actually recognize Solo's name a lot more than I recognize Scythe, to be honest.
Interesting.
So I'm surprised he wasn't actually the one voted in top three. But so Solo is actually pretty good. Mm-hmm. Again, like Probe has been apparently on like pretty good as well. I just do not know as much about the Australian team except for Aegis.
Yeah.
So I feel like just inherently there's a little bit of bias towards Solo for knowing him, mm-hmm. basically. But we'll see. I guess we'll see, of course, what the PVZ looks like, what the Protoss looks like. Because if it's just going to be Dark Shrine, Forge Gate into attack, I feel like Solo should be like totally prepped for that.
Well, yeah. But it's also like a super solid strategy that
it
has
is.
A lot of... How should I say that? Like follow-ups to it after that. You can either all in, you can go for a straight-up macro game, take up, or just, you know, make a lot of units. There's a lot of stuff that you can do and also show a lot about your skills and your army control and army management. So we'll see where Probe stands in. But that's the Norwegian lineup. Snoot, obviously... Captain, everything is well and perfect with this guy. He's been one of the greatest foreign hopes for like the last couple of years. Solo is actually in the team, not even cited as a sub. He's actually in the team. Solo, our Zerg player, and Evire, the Protoss player that we've seen a little bit here yesterday. That's a really like well-rounded lineup, right?
I think so. So those stats are a little bit weird, of course. He has like nothing versus Protoss and all versus Terran, but I don't know. That looks like a solid lineup. It's actually a really good picture, Solo, by the way.
What's
like A+. It's a good picture, Solo.
Pretty good picture of him. It looks perfectly fine on this one. And we can take a look at the precedent results from Norway. So first in Nation Wars 1, first in Nation Wars 2, and then top 12 in Nation Wars 3. They actually didn't perform as well as we expected in Nation Wars 3. It's just like I feel like they won, and especially Snoot, because I know that's a tournament that he loves, obviously. Winning in front of the French crowd during Nation Wars 2 was something that he really enjoyed. So I'm guessing they want to make a difference in Nation Wars 4 here.
Yeah, of course, right? Like, and I think a lot of it is on Snoot's shoulders, but apparently his faith in his teammates apparently did pretty well yesterday. Here's the Australian lineup. Of course, Aegis is not actually Rory Swan from StarCraft 2, so that's what he looks like. Mm-hmm. Seether, as well as Probe, and I guess their sub is Azur. They didn't even participate in the last two Nation Wars.
Yeah.
Or the one before...
The first two Nation Wars. Nation Wars 3, top 16. They actually made it out of qualifiers, but they stopped in the group stage. So I think, once again, for Australia, pretty cool team, pretty well-rounded team, but mostly the heavy hitter that we know in Aegis. And then I know a lot of people actually love Probe and say that he's a really, really great player, and that's really cool because he's going to be the first one to be playing for Australia. Can you show me the predictions again? Because I can't even remember what I said.
Right.
I think I said 4-1 Norway.
Yeah, I think you were 4-1 and I was 4-2. And I think Roddy was also 4-2 for Norway.
Okay, 4-1, 4-2, 4-2. Then.
Something, 4-2, 4-2, 4-1?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, everybody thinks that Norway... Yeah, thank
there
you.
There we go.
4-2, 4-2, and 4-1. So everybody thinks that Norway is going to take it. But then it's a matter of how many losses they're going to get. Or is Australia is actually going to make us look bad once again?
Mm.
Because we did predict it, USA to advance before. So we're just bad at the prediction game.
Yeah.
I hope I'm pretty sure Roddy is actually kind of mad about it because we didn't show the predictions from yesterday, even though he was right 100% of the time.
He was. Apparently.
And today we show his first prediction. He's actually missing it by quite a bit. So GG Roddy. Map pool is here. Overgrowth. That's a map that you obviously know a lot about, but it's gonna be the battlefield for game one. Roddy is actually enjoying my comment from earlier. Just gave me a no. That was nice.
Yeah, basically a peace symbol.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. So,
Overgrowth, first map, PVZ. So, if Probe can take out Solo, like, how soon will we see Snoot? Like, that's the thing that I'm wondering about, because my prediction is 4-1, so I'm guessing they lose one game, then Snoot comes in 4-0.
Right, that's actually what I predict for, like, most teams, but actually, like, I've never been... I think I was actually like technically team captain of one team like 4 years ago, but this is like Clan War C League, you know what I mean? So, but I don't know what's in the mind of the team captains, but that's actually what I would expect too. Is due to come out once they, of course, have realized who their opponent was going to be. Looking at some tweets here, some rapid casting, and I didn't. Oh, there he is.
Yeah.
Well, it's a picture of Nathanius.
Maybe he changed it because he wanted to show how much passion he had for the American team.
How beautiful.
So yeah, that's the face of a man. Watching Bly on Fire all kill America. I know, like, this is a hard feeling for Roddy because he's trying to tell us that it's all about Netherlands, but he's also a true American hot.
He is,
you know?
Yes.
He's been living in California for like the last 3 years.
He,
so
he knows more about America than I do. We actually like brought up 50 states at dinner, and I was just like, it's like Texas right there. I don't know.
And Netanyahu obviously says that he will be back with vengeance tomorrow, not out of his group yet. Yes, that's actually kind of smart to point out because this is a GSL double elimination format. So basically, USA lost that first game, but they're not out of the tournament. They will be playing against the loser of this match. So either Norway or Australia. The Aussies, they can definitely make it past Norway. That's not something that we expected, but that's something they could do. And the format of Nation Wars makes it for every single team that can actually do super well. Like, think about Croatia yesterday, taking two wins out of Korea. Nobody would have expected that. And even though that had even that happened anyway. So Australia definitely has a shot, but Norway, with their history in Nation Wars and with Snoot in high form, should be okay for them. And we've seen a little bit about the brackets.
Yep.
The team that's going to win here is going to have to play against Ukraine and obviously against Bly.
Yeah, apparently
he's definitely on fire.
Yeah, Bly's on fire, and he can continue that momentum too as the winner's match that we played today. Mm-hmm. So it's coming up next. But I, like, you know, Snoot mentioned in the interview that it just, you feel bad for who's in the loser's bracket right now. Like, USA was supposed to win against Ukraine, and now they're in the loser's bracket facing what we expect to be Australia. But if it's Norway, I actually agree with Snoot. I think Snoot actually like takes on Neeb usually, and especially if Neeb's a little off form. If this was like an indication of that, then I think Snoot does take it.
Yeah. So we'll see about those games in a couple of seconds because I believe the game one is about to start. So don't worry, you'll have some game footage in a couple of seconds. We've been talking a lot with the interview, with the predictions, with everything. But StarCraft is going to take its own place in a few moments. What do we have to add? Nothing, because the game is live.
Perfect.
See, that was a perfect
time.
You
meant to do that.
Yes. In the top right, here in Overgrowth, as the Protoss player representing Australia, this is Probe.
In the bottom left for Norway, he is the Red Zerg Solo. Alright, Overgrowth, a very simple map. It is the Daybreak of 2014, I think, 15 was it? And then, of course, Daybreak's also in the map pool, so some of the most standard maps.
Exactly.
Not the Nightmare Pool, an actual, almost, dream pool, but when is it going to be standard? And as far as I know, we do not have any Bly-like players in the lineup right here. I guess I think done like one or two kind of cheeky things as Terrence can, but even then not too often. And as far as I know from Probe and Solo, as we can see here, it's just standard stuff. I mean, Probe goes for what is like that kind of like middle of the road, like the safe expand after Gateway, and Solo is getting hatchery first and then a spawning pool.
And the hole in his wall is actually on the right side, as Kevin was showing us. So we will be taking, you know, we'll be keeping track of every single wall for every single Protoss player throughout the tournament on Overgrowth, because obviously the entire game is based on that wall. Like, obviously, the results will come out because of this. On the Zerg side of things, we have a hatchery first into a pool. So right now, nothing too crazy. He's going to gather some gas, probably. We'll go into Speedling. And second assimilator for Protoss, Cybernetics Core. Obviously, we're waiting for the type of strategy that they'll be using. We haven't seen that many Stargates, to be honest, in PvZ ever since the beginning of the tournaments.
Yeah, actually, I mean, 90%, I want to say, like, I'm pretty confident that number of PvZs are going for the Robo Twilight Council DT. But, I mean, what's actually been coming back a little bit are those Adept Rushes. We've seen a few of those in the past couple of matches.
Uh-huh.
And, Neeb actually had a Stargate build, but we saw how that ended against a Nidus Worm, so I don't know.
What about that Chrono-Boosted Stalker, though? That's something that you don't see every day, right?
Yeah, I'm not sure about that. I mean, I would say that usually can you can't usually take out the Overlord. So I mean, it's gonna crawl across the map. That's pretty bold.
Can he get the one on the right? Like, does he expect? Can he see it with the Zelnaga? He will see it, I think.
Well,
super close, but he does.
Yeah, I guess his probe did scout the timing on that gas, so he would have known that it was, you know, was obviously not like a pull first, and he would be able to take out that Overlord. That's actually really cool.
Yeah, it's a great
something
pick-off.
That, like, you know, Marines can do and TVZ as well. And that was a good scout, a good read of how, well, most players do send out their Overlord. So pretty nice right there.
Yeah, getting that overworld snipe. Not actually gonna supply block a little bit on Norwegian player Solo, who did get his third hatchery down, even though the probe was just around trying to harass and maybe plant down a pylon. Didn't go for it. There was two Zerglings, so he didn't go for it. But as we can see, Twilight and Robo, this is going to be the infamous double Archon drop.
Yeah.
And I want to see the best micro there is from Probe. Like, a lot of people have been saying that Probe is a super solid player, and I guess this is the kind of opening that shows how good you are with your army management. So I just want to see a lot of units dying and Archons just never die, actually.
Yeah, it's a test for both players, as far as I can see it. Like, you know, yeah. It's a test of the Protoss. Can he do the solid macro follow-up, the solid micro decision-making, of course, DTs or Archons right off the bat. And then for the Zerg, it's also, I feel like, a bit of a test, you know, too. Like, can he even defend against the first Archons? And if so, then I guess they can continue on the game in a macro sense.
Yeah.
I really like that Overlord pickoff, too, like, just to talk more about that, because that's not just, like, okay, you made a supply block, that was 100 minerals, that's another Larva. It's also that you don't have to worry about another set of Ling drops if you were facing someone who did that. And it's also a lack of potential scouting. Of course, the one on the left side you can't really kill unless you did open up with that Stargate. And a lot of Protosses do put all of their tech in their natural now, but there's always that potential. So I actually really like that. Now, you can guess, as we've been saying, like, a lot of Protosses are going for the Gateway Dark Shrine, but the follow-up is also important to scout.
Yeah.
So as we think, I think Solo just completely just skipped Overlord's speed. He's not too worried about getting that follow-up scout. He's going to be depending more on his Ling scouting. These are going to go back as they see that warp prism. They probably know what's up without even scouting the Dark Shrine.
Yeah, interestingly enough, like, super fast third base by Probe just after his prism came out, and the overlord has been moved a little bit from the ledge to the right of your screen right there, so he doesn't see exactly what's going on inside the wall of Probe, but he does get that third Nexus scout, which is so important too. So kudos to Solo for having a proper scout right there. Those 40 Ts, they're going to come in, try to get some damage done, but there's an Overseer and a Spore, so we will have to get out of here with this Prism and then probably come back in a few seconds with the Archon. The first steps of that PVZ Tango actually goes for Solo. He's been defending this pretty well for now.
Yeah, I know a lot of Protosses who just go for the Archons immediately. Mm-hmm. They just assume there's going to be Spore Crawlers, and usually there are. Again, it's such a common build opener, but I actually really like the Protosses who test it first, because occasionally you'll find people who are only using Queens to defend, which GT's going to actually take on, or they'll just be able to snipe the Spore Crawler because they're out of position first.
Exactly.
So I like the attempt. It didn't really work out, and he's just, you know, harassing one side is really, like, obviously Solo knows where the Warp Prism is. He's going to have units there all ready to go, and enough roaches to deal with it too. Hydra's then already on the way, but no attempts to actually cancel out that third base, so they're both going to get into this really good macro stage.
Exactly, and we can see, like, triple prob production, so Probe is not really going for this like a super all-in transition. This is not a fake Nexus by any means. He's got 58 probes to actually mine from this one. So everything good and fine in this game. He actually warped in two more DTs that controlled the Zelnaga for a moment. But I like that tiny difference, because if he was to make a lot of damage to the right with his Prism in Archon, he could have squeezed in a couple DTs in the main, and that ends up being super, super difficult to hold on as a Zerg player if you defend with your entire army the DTs. Mm-hmm. Like, you one-shot a drone, so basically every time a DT will swipe once, you will lose a lot of economy because of that. So, four space, forward, on the gold, Solo going for a mass hydraulic play with the plus one and the speed for the Hydras right there.
Yeah, I mean, I don't really mind this at all. If you do expect the game to go into this macro game, not the fake third base we were talking about, not an immediate follow-up of Blink Stalkers or Resident Glaze, of course it's Blink here, then yeah, take the forward gold base, get your drones over there, and be very comfortable around the 66 drone mark. So eventually we're, of course, going to get something a bit more exciting going on. Roaches and Hydras. Hydras finally getting their upgrades. Actually, plus one also done. I think Solo could start taking a bit of the map, as, like, no one's really, like, poking forward with either armies. Probably a bit more viable for the Zerg player, but going to break down his rocks first. He does see the Warp Prism. I guess the Warp Prism is always going to be in the back of your mind, because if it's not the Archons, the Depth Warp-ins, it's the DT Warp-ins. Mm-hmm. Something you always have to be worried about. When it's two Archons, they really are looking for some light damage. Only occasionally do they get these beautiful shots and, like, clumped-up drones.
He got a pretty nice shot right there, getting an overlord and the creep tumor that was just below. So actually getting a little bit lucky. And we see now the kind of technology that Probe would wants to go for, a second robo and a robo bay. So it can either be disruptors, right, but also a tiny bit of Colossus, because if he did scout a lot of high risk, I don't think anything wrong with doing a lot of Colossus, producing a lot of Colossus. So we'll see what he decides to go for, but right now a tiny poke, two Immortals, couple of sentries and three Archons to tank in the middle. Those force fields are actually not useful at all. Like the Archons just smash them. And right now, he's actually just losing units.
I was going to say, if he's confident in his force fields, then poking like this is not that big of a problem. But he did go out with his entire army, not just the Blink Stalker. So if he had to retreat, he would need to throw down force fields. He's actually just losing sentries now. So pops the Guardian Shield, but Solo's not actually looking for that fight. He was willing to, you know, take the fight and then, you know, threaten kind of a counterattack, but he's going to look for a better position on that left side where the army still has not even seen.
Vision.
There's actually no vision at all. He's going to be entirely... Oh my god, this actually is pretty bad.
Yeah, this is really, really bad for Probe. He's actually going to throw down triple overcharge right there, but nothing to defend those pylons, so they're already dying, and this is a really clumped up Poros army. He needs to blink out and avoid those corrosive vials. Not that many Hydralisk in the mix, so he can probably take it in with those Stalkers, but now... No force field, so those Stalkers are actually taking a lot of damage. That first, that first disruptor, that was a nice shot from Probe, and that's probably what he needed to hold on to this game. Maybe second disruptor comes in.
The second disruptor would be huge. Actually, gonna like just that was a little bit scary. That will probably, he's starting to lose on his Blink Stalkers. The ones on the right side didn't last as long as they thought they would. The disruptors are actually out of shots. Oh, the Nexus actually went down. He realized it was getting so low, and that might just be enough. Now, Probe does already have a fourth base, and he does manage to take out the last remnants of the Zerg player, but losing that third base, that hurt, especially because Solo is, of course, on a fourth and a gold.
Exactly, yeah. Solo is just going for the mass unit style, not going to go for any higher take that we don't see. Lurker Den or anything, no more upgrades. He's just going to go for a mass hatchery style, lots of roaches and ravagers and hydras, and that's a really cool strat against a Protoss that actually tried to move out a little bit too early in this game and dropped a little bit of units. Once again, the disruptors are going to do their job. You don't want to lose those sentries on the right. Yeah. Just bleeding a little bit of units. I think Probe, like, right now he's holding on, and I'm liking his composition a little bit better, to be honest.
Well, Probe's problem right now is that he doesn't have his gases. He didn't, he lost the third base that had the gases, and then his fourth base never got the gases, even as he sent the probes over there. So that's like a really big issue. He can't warp in more sentries. He can't warp in more stalkers if he's planning on still getting the disruptors. And the disruptors are really what's letting him hold on to life here. Mm-hmm. They've actually done a great job. They're perfectly clutch in the actual battle, but also defending that top ramp. Bit of harassment in the adepts here is pretty nice, but I do question it a little. I don't know. It's, again, like, he's so low on that gas, but it does end up doing more damage. He's also pulled to the right side. He saw the army moving across. Kind of a... I actually didn't take him here from natural.
I mean, he didn't lose a prism. He just lost a couple of adepts. I don't think that was too bad, but only getting four drones, like, in terms of that move being worth it. Like, in terms of mineral, exactly, that wasn't worth it, but it's not like he's dying because of it, because he used all his warp-ins towards the other side of the map. So I'm not totally against it, but I agree with you that in the position that he's in this game, I think, like, the future looks kind of bright for Probe and not that much for Solo. So just, like, camp a little bit, get that huge army, get, probably try to get maxed out and probably finish the game when you can, because he gets the plus two. He's actually getting a lot of disruptors. I think he has about six or seven of them at the moment, and he's still producing some.
Yeah. The disruptors are, they've been key, and they will continue to be key against Solo, who, his best bet right now is to, basically split. He's getting the higher tech. He's going up to that hive. He's defending his bases against the DT harassment as well. Not taking too much damage there, but things have really evened out. From Probe losing his third base, but I guess saving all of his probes, immediately transferring to the fourth base, it didn't actually impact him that much, and he's even now a bit ahead in supply as Solo has gone a little bit down in drones.
Yeah, I like Probe's position. Like, he doesn't want to take a fight too early, I guess, in this game, and he still lacks a little bit of a backbone in his army. I would like to see a little bit more adepts or maybe a little bit more stalkers, because I feel those disruptors are a little bit vulnerable. But this game could actually go crazy instantly if he gets, like, a really, really decent disruptor shot. We are still on Roach, Ravager, Hydra, which is not a high-tech army at all, by any means. So you could get, like, destroyed instantly by a nice disruptor shot. And this one, Actually, he's going to whiff, but it looks super scary every time it happens.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, he has so many... Oh, my God. Oh, that last minute split was actually like the best he could do. There's so many disruptors that Probe, as long as he doesn't literally send them all at one time, he'll be able to retreat with them, which is, of course, the most important thing in case Solo did get an opportunity to move forward. But this is about Probe finding an opportunity to push into Solo to actually get those good disruptor shots before Solo can get to a Greater Spire, which has just begun.
Yeah, he still has a couple of seconds to go before that Greater Spire will be out. And he's going to try to take the fight. This one connecting with a lot of roaches. This one again with some Hydras and a Queen. And I think he has the army available to take this fight. He still needs the Disruptor shots. Like, he has nothing but Adepts and Stalkers. And in terms of upgrades, those two players are tied. So lots of Hydras, if they can hit, if they can shoot for a little bit of time, this is going to deal a lot of damage. Stalkers, Gateway units, they don't fend that great against Hydras. So he needs those Disruptor to be key on the left side. No, that was a preemptive shot. The army wasn't even moving from Solo, but he's going to lose the gold. So already getting something out of it, I guess.
I do like that Solo just gave that up as opposed to try and save it, because once he lost that high ground position, I think that was a better way to go. And he did have to respond to that War Prism, just unable to actually siphon off the appropriate amount of units just by themselves. But it's better to lose that base and just maybe take it back later. He was banking so much. I mean, the reason the supplies looked grim was because, like, 30 supply was supposed to be in those Broodlords.
Yep.
The last second, he did decide to max out more on those Roaches, which is a bit of a problem. He'll be able to get so many Broodlords and the Corruptors that he has. But he was able to defend. You know, this game still continues on, where if I think he defended that gold base, he could have gotten Disruptors to the face and just lost right there.
Yeah, and the five Broodlords are actually going to come out in a few seconds from Solo. So he did win enough time to get that high-tech technology, and there's nothing to counter it. We have, like, pretty decent upgrades and Blink, obviously, but nothing like Void Rays or Tempest to actually contest those Broodlords. And he realizes it a little bit too late. Yeah. Those two Stargates, I feel they're a little bit late to the party. And if now Solo decides to cross the map with all his Broodlords and all his Roach and Ravagers, I think it's going to look a little bit grim for Probe. Like, at least he needs to take out the freshly built gold from Probe. Like, he needs to make stuff happen with those Broodlords, but that disruption is massive, and that's a really great offensive leap. Why is he going back?
I'm surprised.
I felt like he could have taken more Broodlords win this one.
Yeah, I think maybe like two or three, but I guess he was expecting that the position would be too good, so he wouldn't be able to take all of them out. that was pretty good. I was going to say eight Broodlords is pretty good, but really decent Blink Stalker positioning. Maybe they will go down, but that's usually like you have to be out in the middle of the map, and the Blink Stalkers really have to be already prepared for that. And the Broodlords, I mean, this is maybe one of those opportunities. He does blink forward, he gets a couple of the Broodlords. I mean, the Disruptors are actually getting great shots too, and it's actually going great for Probe.
Probe just destroying Solo. Jeez. Right there with a really decisive forward blink and those Disruptor. I guess Terrans have a lot of issue with this when you want to push into a forward army of Protoss, but this time that was the same with Derg, and Probe takes the first win for Australia. That looked a little grim. Like, I felt those Broodlords were not answered, and I actually don't like Solo's position. Like, I don't like him going in the middle of the map where the Blink Stalkers can actually have some surface area to blink around and maneuver around your Broodlord.
Exactly.
If you go to the left and try to pressure the gold, like with the high ground and everything, I think your Broodlords are actually way more safe. And in this case, getting going for a straight-up engagement wasn't the right decision from Solo, I guess.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, my point about the Blink Stalkers getting that good position is exactly what happened in the middle of the map. I think if you're going to push into the middle of the map confidently with Broodlords, you either have Fungals, I guess, as well, or you have maybe like 14 Broodlords, not 8, so that the Broodlings actually take on the Stalkers, so, and you force them to get to those Tempests. But here we see a lot of the important engagements going down. Yeah. This one looked like it would be okay. Solo or Probe pulled back, but it ended up going to a better fight as the Broodlords were pulled out of position. And actually, that was like some really good late game control from Probe.
Exactly. Like, he waited, he baited the army once again, and we can see the last fight straight up blink to the right, and there is nothing to defend. All the Disruptors are actually going to crush every single unit on the ground. Perfect engagement by Probe, but also, as we mentioned, maybe not the right place to fight for Solo. That game gave that position away. And
yeah.
Yeah, you obviously don't want to fight. You want it, like those are siege units, like tanks, like Colossi. You want to have like a proper position to defend those broodlords. Yeah. And the middle of the map around Zelnaga with a lot of vision for Protoss was obviously not the right place to fight.
I think Solo probably thought a little like, you know, oh, I have broodlords and he doesn't have Tempest. Let's go for it. Because a lot of times the Stalkers cannot find a decent position, or you do see some Protosses overcommit with the Stalkers in bad positions, something like that. But no, Probe actually handled that very, very well. That was actually really cool. PVZ. We're about to find out Norway's next player, though, in 2-1-0.
No.
Saving their best player
for last. They're saving for last, indeed. Ivar will be the player sent out for Norway trying to take out Probe. So, do we like the chances of Ivar? Do we like his chances?
I don't know enough about
him. PvP.
Like, apparently he's on Dead Pixels, which is like, you know, it's actually a pretty decent team, but not a guy that I've really heard a lot about. I don't believe he had a breakout performance yesterday. It was actually more about...
He won one game.
Oh, he won one game.
That was the cute thing about Norway yesterday, is that even though Snoot was needed to finish the job, both player before actually took one game each. So that made the work a little bit easier for Snoot. We are gonna go and play on Whirlwind, which for PvP I guess can be a cool map. Maybe we'll see like some max out army and some carriers. Did you see like carrier against carrier ever since the new patch in PvP?
In PvP,
I didn't get to cast any game like this.
No way.
You don't think that can happen?
Actually, I'm like really questioning if that can ever happen. I mean, first of all, PvP is just like there's like seems to be a lack of them overall. But also, there's just so much emphasis. I mean, the early game, the mid game is usually so back and forth. It's actually a really nice matchup. I enjoy it quite a bit. But then it's always to that Blink Soccer Disruptor. And Disruptors being so expensive, it's really hard to kind of like either sneak in those Stargates to like surprise your opponent, or actually just last long enough to get to that like 5-6 base you would need.
I see what you mean. And I actually anticipate maybe a cross position on Whirlwinds for that to happen, but this is not the case. This is vertical, and in top left for Australia, he won game one with amazing disruptor control. This is Probe, representing Root Gaming.
And in the bottom left for Norway, he is the red Protoss Ivar. That's how I'm going to pronounce it, sure.
Yeah.
So Probe, I mean, it's a good thing that he showed us excellent disruptor control. There's only a couple of mistakes here and there where he lost one or two, or maybe didn't have enough to cover his retreat type deal. Mm-hmm. You know, it wasn't a perfect game last game, and that's why I think I enjoyed it so much, because I'm so used to seeing like the PVZs that just, you know, they end because the DTs didn't do enough damage, or they end because they did too much damage, or the follow-up all-in is way too common. But that was a macro game that had different points for both players. You know, the third base going down looked risky, but actually Probe was still in control. Probe, I mean, the best thing about Protosses, in my opinion, the one that like really stands out from other Protosses, is when they can actually stay calm and in control, because units are just so precious. You don't, you know, just do something like a Ling run by and go, I guess it didn't work. Like, no, it's usually pretty important to the Protoss and their units out. So that gives me a lot of confidence in Probe. And of course, in a PvP, where the disruptors are eventually going to come out,
of
like
course.
99% of the time.
Yeah. I agree with you on this one. I feel like Probe showed some pretty cool stuff in the previous game. Like the fact that he didn't panic at all, like even though he didn't have the proper technology to fight off those Broodlords. Like I felt he was a little bit indecisive for a couple of minutes before the Broodlords came out. Like I felt like he could have won this game before Broodlords were ever in play. But when they were, like the positioning and the disruptor shot that he did by the moment the Broodlords were out were super, super key. So this time we have an adept opening from Ivar, a double stalker for Probe, who's actually trying to scout a lot and trying to find out where those adepts were. He missed them by a couple of inches there. Is this Nexus in the right place?
I would hope so.
Okay. It falls super, super far away from me for a moment. I don't know. Okay, it seems fine. But those two adepts, they get to scout. They know everything about it. It seems like a proper place, Nexus. The adept, are they going to accept the shades? You don't want to go for it. You don't want to lose them early on. Sorry.
Yeah. There's a pretty infamous game, actually, where someone was facing Pulse, and they, like, misplaced their command center or the next set of, I forget who it was, and as soon as they did that, they canceled and left the game. They were like,
I guess.
I can't win versus Pulse if I misplaced it. It couldn't have been a command center, because I would just let that finish, but the point is, it was
It would be
funny.
Even funnier if he was a Terran player that didn't know that he could lift his command center. Like, oh, I guess I guess I have to go.
No, I'm screwed still. So yeah, the Adepts actually chose to shade through there, but I wasn't anticipating them doing much damage anyway. Usually, by this point, the Mothership Core is out, the pawns have been placed, and the Stalkers, of course, too, on their backs would have helped, you know, DPS them down too fast.
Ooh, fast Prism by Evair, going for a Twilight console first. What kind of technology is he going to go for? Because it's just producing that Prism at the moment. It doesn't have the gas to do that much, so I'm guessing Blink will be the first choice.
It usually is. Again, like 99% of these games of PvP, like once upon a time, there is a big mixture, you know, what exactly style do I want to do, but it's really come down to Blink Stalker, Disruptor. We've been seeing a lot of games actually hold off in Disruptors for some time, like the Immortal Blink Stalker battles have actually like gained a lot of traction in the mid-game, but eventually Disruptors. So seeing Resonant and Glaives actually from Probe makes this a bit more of an interesting PvP.
It is. Like I kind of remember, like for a moment, I talked with Drogo about it around the time when BlizzCon came out. He was telling me that all the rage was like making a lot of Adepts.
Yeah.
So you drop that Twilight console and you get those Raiders and Enclave. Cute micro from Probe actually saving that Adept that was taking a lot of damage from Evair. Two Adepts actually dropped in the main by Evair. Not a single kill yet on the economy. And as you mentioned, one side of the Protoss player actually choosing to go for Blink and the other one for the Resonating Glaive. So I'm guessing, what is he going to do with it? You need to be careful with that Prism.
I mean, Resonating Glaives, I mean, at the when it was like super popular to do, it would just be mass Resonating Glaives. And someone tried to go Disruptors or anything else, they would simply get overwhelmed.
Yeah.
But the key thing was that they ended up getting to enough Disruptors, either against Resonating Glaives or sometimes there's like people playing with charge lots. Mm-hmm. If they got to like four or five Disruptors, it just, you know, they would always be too clumped up. There's just no winning at that point. So there is, of course, this like, yeah, timing's not quite the right word, but a situation where you're just going to simply overwhelm these cheaper upgraded units, Resonating Glaives, you can actually defeat. And of course, the Immortals can only help out so much against them too. We actually have
this looks like a super
centuries?
Cheeky play. Yeah,
wow.
Four sentries in that Prism, and once again, Evair are gonna get a little bit of damage done with that Prism with two Adepts. So really tiny investment to put a little bit of pressure on his opponent, and at the same time, lots of Adepts. So, what's the key here? Is he gonna go for a block on the ramp as Kevin is showing us? Is he gonna try to grab that Immortal as soon as possible with Force Field? Because once again, like shades don't get blocked by those Adepts, and he's gonna go for the ramp.
Oh my goodness.
For the most cheeky play of all time, the Adepts are going to shade into the main. And hello, Force Field, you can't do anything. Amazing play. Amazing play by Probe right there. That's a Mothership Core.
Oh, no.
Needs to save it.
Well, luckily, they won't go down that quickly to the Sentry. Stalkers actually try and blink out the deal and everything, but the Adepts are just too much. The Sentries still aren't being killed either. And the Immortals, they really aren't helping that much. Again, funnily enough, the Mothership Core is living through this, and the Adepts can't do very much about it, but finally going to go down. That Warp Prism barely survives. That last Stalker goes down for Evair, and I think Probe has just done it.
Probe, what a cheeky Aussie. Australia setting his foot strong in this best of seven. Probably going to go and on to a second win in a row with a really, really cool play. Prism, Force Field brings back memory from 2010. But the timing, the perfect timing, with all those Adepts shading in at the last possible moment. And now those Immortals have been waiting for half a minute to fight. And now there's actually 25 Adepts surrounding them. Bye-bye, Immortals. Bye-bye, Evair. 2-0 for Australia.
GG. Probe, I mean, bringing out, as you said, the old school strats. I love it. Finally, Protoss getting a taste of their own medicine, right?
Yeah.
but it's just so unexpected. So I was talking about the Adepts and how they can overwhelm, and that's something that it's possible Evair was expecting if he saw the Adepts. I don't even think he saw the warp-ins from the warp prism.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, mass warp-ins of Adepts overwhelming you. Okay, we've played that. Even Terrans have played against that. Zergs have played against that. But the Sentry thing? Like, that's just not common anymore, especially in PvP. I loved it.
Actually, this is so good that we're going to show that exact play again for you guys. See the timing of the Adept shedding in, and now Force Field in the ramp. Immortals just stuck behind it. They look super, super stupid right there. The blink was actually done, so he could blink inside the main, but that Prism Micro from Pro, because the Prism is obviously pivotal in this attack, he's actually going to be able to save it, even though there's a lot of work in the bottom side of your screen. You could have seen like the Blink Stalker actually blinked again to get that Prism, but the Micro from Probe, amazing, and just, you know, proper decision making and a really cool build, I guess.
Yeah, that build is just super cool. Like, that's one I would steal and just do over and over again, because I feel like there's not much else that, like, one was going to expect it, and then it is just like a super cheesy move. If you hate PvP, go for that. Everyone expects the Dark Shrine, but not the Sentries.
Yeah, really, really great play, and obviously the last player for Norway, because we're actually already talking about the last player. This is 2-0. The only one remaining is none other than Snoot. Does he have what it takes?
I think Snoot does. But Probe, I mean, he's got that momentum. He probably feels pretty good right now. Mm-hmm. He already defeated one Zerg player. Snoot is one of the best foreigners ever at this point, I believe. Highest earning, too, I think. Yep. So it's going to be different, but I think it's going to be Probe's test, and I think he's going to be willing to like take it on, you know? Mm-hmm.
No, really, really great play from Probe, and actually a really scary opponent, as it seems. The best aspect of Nation War is that the games aren't super slick, but they are super fun to watch. Well, just wait until the round of 8 and the round of 4 if the games are not super slick. But I agree with you that there's a lot of cool stuff happening and a lot of cool storylines, I guess. Roddy wants to speak in stereo. Sure, no problem. Sorry about that first microphone not working, Roddy, but you did amazing. I think we were picking up your voice a little bit from TKL's micro, so no problem whatsoever. 2-0, so that means we're going to go into a quick commercial break, and when we return, Probe, with two wins under his belt, is going to face off against Snoot. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back, and Australia is winning 2-0 against Norway, something that we didn't anticipate. I guess the score is not that bad yet, because Snoot is still in the running for Norway, but the way everything happened, it was quick, and it was like brutal, I guess.
I mean, it was like a bit of a warm-up in that first game, but that second game with Probe was absolutely brutal. Yeah. Like, oh my God.
Like, no, you don't get to play.
Yeah, exactly.
Just die right
now.
Anything.
So unfortunate. But now he's going to go against Snoot, as we were talking about before the break. Just, you know, it's a different type of player. It didn't matter, Zerg. He has so much, like, star power behind him, too. It's going to be on Daybreak, so a pretty standard map for this next PVZ, second one of the series.
Well, we could see late game coming from Snoot, obviously, in such a huge macro map. I don't expect Snoot to try and win too early. That's not his style. He might win in the mid game, but there is also a pretty huge probability that he goes for those late game army. And we'll see, I guess, the difference in army control compared to solo in game one that actually reached that status, that Broodlord state in the game, but didn't really handle it that way. For now, we need to introduce that guy in the bottom left for Australia is Protoss. And right now, 2-0 under his belt, Probe. Super exciting to watch.
Mm-hmm. In the top right, as the red Zerg for Norway, he is Snoot. So I think Snoot will have better control should they get to that very, very late game. But I also am not sure he'll play that same composition to get to a similar late game. A lot of what Snoot has been doing, I mean, we all know him as a macro monster, so I definitely think it's going to be macro, yeah. But of course, what he's been made famous for in this matchup is his, like, mass painlings, for instance. So I kind of expect something like that, not necessarily the Roach Hydra that we saw from solo earlier, and maybe Probe will have some more difficulty against that. As he's, you know, we're saying, like, his arm positions, they got better throughout the game. Like, that one time he was severely out of position looked quite brutal, but he's been warmed up. He's feeling,
feeling
the momentum.
Cheeky.
He's feeling cheeky. That's like the first time I think I've ever seen a worker do a tag. Ever.
I guess, like, you should do it every single game, though. Like I'm also waiting on, a proxy hatchery, a matter hatchery, a matter nexus or something, so we can see, the country tag just coming right after it. Like, you take you do a proxy hatchery on the second base, and it actually finishes, and you get like a really cool Australian logo or Norwegian logo on that forward hatchery. But we'll see. We can only dream. But for now, cheeky tag. That's the only thing he did for now. But he did scout with that probe, and he knows what Snoot is up to, which is basically super standard hatchery, gas, and spawning pool. Mm-hmm. So, would you expect just that Banelink kind of style? Even though, like, last time I really, really paid attention to what Snoot was doing in PvZ was that game against Drogo, where he actually pushed during BlizzCon, I mean.
Oh, okay.
Where he actually pushed making Banelink to another level, which is I'm gonna make a million Banelinks. I'm gonna mine six times as more as you do, but I'll still lose eventually because Archons are pretty good against Banelinks.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Snoot was actually unbeatable. I feel in this matchup for like a month, he was unbeatable versus Terran for a month as well, and he was unable to really showcase that when it came to BlizzCon, which was just so sad. I know that he was really disappointed in that too.
Of course.
But yeah, a lot of it was mass Banelings, but Protosses have started figuring it out. Of course, mass Banelings have actually been upgraded with their most recent patch once they have the triple hooks. It's now longer just Bane speed, it's a Bane boost, they get the plus 10 health, and they think it's a good way to go. They actually have Dark Shrine on the way already.
Yeah, it's a Dark Shrine first, actually,
yeah,
not even Robo. So that's more of a cheeky Dark Shrine to actually make DTs. This is not what you could anticipate instantly as a DT drop. I mean, the build is slightly different, and I guess Snoot will have to scout it because the timing is going to be a little bit different than what the one is supposed to expect, I guess. He's going to be able to scout that Dark Shrine, so maybe I'm just mistaken and the timing is a little bit different, but I felt like the Robo was a little bit late.
Yeah, that was still a really fast Dark Shrine, but it is still coming to the same thing, which is going to be DT drops. But Ling's actually trying to break through here. I'm a little surprised that he forced the issue. Lost a couple of Lings, but kept definitely enough alive to continue scouting. His Overlord's going to be able to scout the Blink or the Twilight Council researching as well. It's actually moving a little out of position now, but it went back to check after it was finished. We have a Roachmore on the way. I think the best way to deal with most early mid-game aggression for Boros is to have both units available, basically Roaches and Speedlings. Again, some people, they'll go for Banelings, which I don't think is like too bad, as it isn't mass adepts here, but the point is like just a couple of splits, and just I think the Roaches are a safer choice. Plus, Snoot has always really liked going for like these super safe 6 to 8 Roaches, and it's turning into Ravagers later.
All right, triple Spore to be extra safe against those early DTs. We'll see if Probes decides to actually poke in with those DTs or go straight to the Archon play. Three more gates actually. How much does that make? Like, is that
5?
Is that
six.
Oh, yeah. He already has 3 warp gates plus 3, which means he's going to have 6. Yes, I did math in stream, and I don't think that I messed that up. 6 gateways. So this is looking like a transition into something even more aggressive. But the fact is, he's still not researching anything on that Twilight Council.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, it'd be a bare bones, only a couple of Archons to help out whatever he warps in. So I guess it is just going to get production before Nexus. We'll see how much he actually does send the probes over there. Of course, the DTs are looking for something to do, but oddly enough, there's only 3 DTs.
Yeah. I think the build is just a little bit weird from Probe. Like, the Dark Shrine was definitely a little bit earlier than what we usually see. And now, like, only 3 DTs. The timing on the gateway is a little bit off on the other one. So if he goes and warps in a lot of adepts to do something with even some zealots, I guess, would make a little bit more sense to me. But getting those early gateways while producing probes, actually, the moment I'm saying this, he actually cut probe production.
Yeah.
He's actually going to go for 5 more DTs.
Oh my god.
And a zealot. Yeah. He's going to push with this.
So, okay, I see where this is starting to go, right? So it is just going to be mostly like an Archon-based push with basic gateways. And that's pretty cool because he could have put Snoot in a really, like, you know, sense of security. You just got to the third base and be like, oh, I guess you're playing the macro follow-up. And oh my god, he didn't do anything. But Snoot did get 11 roaches, not just like 5 and a handful of Lings.
Yeah, he will have
Once he scouts this, I think he can reinforce.
Yeah, he needs to react, and he needs to react fast. Like, gather all his army at the same place, because only 3 roaches towards that third base and a couple of Lings is actually, pulling back because he can't fight this army. 4 Archons will lead the way, and those roaches, they're really clumped up in the on the ramp right there. Maybe he can get something going on for him. Those zealots shredding drones at the same time, and a really cute and weird build from Probe actually dealing some damage right there.
Yeah, this is super weird, and I really like the War Prism micro. The one thing that Roaches could do was actually kite back and try and target fire the Archons. He's trying to land them literally on the Roaches. That was pretty damn cool. Okay. This was so close to, I could see this definitely overwhelming a less prepared Zerg, which a lot of them, they do kind of cut that line of like, well, I know what you're doing because you went DT drop, so I'm just going to get like a handful of Lings and your Queens are going to focus fire the War Prism. But if you only did that, you actually might die against this push.
Exactly.
But Snoot had enough and he reinforced fast enough too. He was trying to build a Spire and he canceled it. He took it very seriously. And now Probe really can't do much more aggression, but the question is, can he recover from that? He did have the third base, but he stopped Probes. Getting there now. Yeah, I mean, it's really about that Twilight Council tech being so late for me. But yeah, he will have blink in time for the Spire.
He will, because the Spire has been restarted instantly after the defense of this push. So Snoot's still alive, still very much alive in this game. 65 workers against the 59 of Probe in the middle of the map. That War Prism is still active, and that's something that I like, because this is... like, this is a unit that's powered up by just APM, like pure APM and multitask. And right now he's showing Probe, that is, that he can do both. He can still go in into a macro game, get that blink, get that immortal, new gateways, assimilators on the third, but still be able to deal some damage in the middle of the map with those archons. Yeah. Fourth base is gonna come out from Zerg, and now it's been scouted from Probe. Right there, just a free Baneling. That's just APM-based. That's just a cool pickup from him.
It's nice moves. He's also going to go ahead and try and poke here. I mean, again, the force fields, if they're on point, then totally viable. If the War Prism is available too, then if you do find a point of aggression, then you can continue being aggressive. I don't know. The timing's going to be so weird. The Spire is finishing, so Snoot... Snoot did already put his gas, not into Mutas, but into everything else. So that's what I was a little bit worried about. On one hand, they maybe take out the War Prism. On the other, I think it's about ground units to defend right here, right now.
Yeah, and going up this ramp is actually going to be super hard against those Ravagers. And in the top of the screen, we've seen Snoot sniping an Observer at the same time, so no vision from Probe. And this is the kind of attack that starts to be really scary, because you don't really know into what kind of composition you're going to go. Now that Overseer is down, maybe he can make something happen with some DTs for a bit, because there's no detection for Zerg, but no. Probe just gonna pull back, and once again, same transition. Double Robo and the Robo Bay gonna go into Disruptor. That's when the Mutas could shine.
That is, yeah, exactly. So I like the way Probe is doing this. Like, you know, on some aspects, I think like visually it might look like a failure, but actually in terms of overall gameplay, I mean, messing Snoot up is kind of, was like the only way to defeat the guy back when he was on fire in this matchup, by doing basically this. You know, he made him make more roaches than he would usually do. He usually just relies on like lings and only a handful of roaches. You made his Mutas much later. So, I mean, they're still going to come out and do what they're mostly intended to, which is to kill the Warp Prism, but you still are messing his build order up a little bit, and actually like having some pretty decent macro behind it too. A fourth base is on the way for Probe, halfway done. I mean, I actually really like enjoy the way Probe's playing. He might still lose, of course, but I'm impressed by this guy.
Yeah, that's just a pretty high-level PvZ, where Protoss actually knows that he can't let a guy with the level of Snoot just doing what he wants on his side of the map, so actually going for those, you know, half off-timing kind of pushes to make Snoot build those units, because as you mentioned, Snoot would have been super content with making 15 Mutas not announced, but instead of that, he had to build those units to defend his fourth, and now those few Mutas, after taking the Prism out, will scout, probably try to get that Force Nexus. We just got a glimpse of an amazing Disruptor shot on four or five Ravagers, and I don't like this fight for Snoot that much.
Yeah, he's very disjointed. I mean, I guess he's starting to bank as much as he should be, so he can like reinforce if he loses one or two pockets of Ravagers. But yeah, not really getting an opportunity to push in so much. And he didn't manage to cancel the fourth base either. I mean, for Probe, I think he knows what Snoot plays. Like, I think he actually knows Snoot, as everyone knows Snoot, right? Yep. But for Snoot, I'm guessing he still doesn't know a lot about Probe. Of course, the server differences are huge between Australia and Norway, so he might be a little bit surprised by this. But I'm saying that Probe probably has a severe advantage, knowing that, like, okay, you're not really going to go into Mutas, but I'm going to get a one target just in case you decide to, but I know what you're going to do.
Snoot's feeling the pressure. He's actually going to go and build a lot of spine crawlers, but those are a little bit late to the party, but those new Banelings actually going to roll in, and no force field, no splits, and once again, a Protoss that gets evaporated by those filthy Banelings. Protoss actually going to go back really, really fast, because he's about to lose the entire army. Look at the supply, 127 against 155, and those 30 more Banelings made a lot of difference. And once again, just missing a few key force fields and I guess some marine splits technology. Splits.
Yeah, he definitely could have split his units in general, but I think he just was like, he had like, I think, what, two force fields that could have maybe saved the day from like a one leftover sentry, and he probably just wasn't tapped into it. So that was certainly a mistake there, but the game's not actually over. He had so many Blinkstalkers who's warping into defending against the Mutas to keep his fourth base alive, and it is still alive and mining, but he might be overextending here. I think he's surrounded by some of the Lings.
Yeah.
He's really trying to make these Blinkstalkers work, but you know, they're also only at plus one.
Exactly.
Usually it's plus two Stalkers is the habit thing to say, but just one upgrade, that's not too great.
Yeah, especially because he's fighting off against Zerglings with plus two attack, which basically are being used to get wraparounds and then get those Biles to connect, but actually those Zerglings are actually dealing a lot of damage with the plus two, so those Stalkers by themselves are not doing the work at all. He's gonna go back once again with that Observer, trying to get a little bit of creep getting out, but he's gonna lose a Forge with the plus two, so this is not a plus two that was about to finish, but that still hurts a lot.
Yeah, you know, I think everything's gonna get so chaotic, he probably won't even remember to place down that Forge again. He's really trying to pressure Snoot, but Snoot's at this position where there's no messing up Snoot really anymore, I feel. Like, he's up to 70 drones on 5 bases, and he has an army. There's no catching him off guard, so I'm not really sure what Probe's hoping to accomplish by doing this. He's just losing Probes, not defending.
Yeah, the Mutas are wrecking everything in the main, and those Stalkers are not doing the job in the middle of the map, especially on creep with those plus 2 upgrades. The Zerglings are shredding everything. 18 more Banelings. Creep plus Spine Crawlers plus Ravagers. This is not looking so well for Probe. He did take 2 victories in a row, but I feel this one is going to go Norway's way, with Snoot still holding on to against that full Stalker army. Just playing amazingly well. The Concave is perfect. Those Banelings will connect. And Probe is doing what he can to hold on to this game, but the GG is going to come in a few seconds, I believe.
Yeah, we also had a counterattack destroying his frontal gateways. GG, well played. Snoot keeps it alive for Norway.
That makes it 2-1, and Snoot does what he's known for. He's going to carry Norway on this one, because Probe looked unstoppable for a moment, and even this game was super close for the longest time until he got those amazing Baneling detonations.
I really liked the way Probe played again. So what's interesting now, of course, is we do have 2 other players for Australia. You know, actually, first, let's actually take a look at some of these really key, actually, this one being the most key.
Still has a lot of energies on those sentries on the right. Like, he could have gotten, like, I'm not saying that he could have destroyed every single Baneling before they reached the army, but just taking a little bit of time to go back, go out of the creep, obviously would have been super good for him, but this time just not doing anything, not splitting, not getting those key force fields. Yeah. And when you've got like 7 or 8 Banelings with plus 2 that connects into a huge pool of Protoss units, like, that's one of the most the most cost-effective thing that you could get as a Zerg player with Banelings against Protoss,
right? That was just really good. And it was, like, so even, too. Like, imagine what 2 Force Fields could have done. I would have loved to, like, resume from Leaf Ray, for instance, but it is over. But to my point earlier, Australia has 2 more players to throw out. Let's say that Snoot is able to get the rest of the players out. Who do they revive? I would actually, like, I mean, Probe might be the revive. Yeah. I know Aegis is like the most famous player on the Australian team right now, but Probe's definitely made a name for himself.
And actually, Probe is pretty happy with himself, and of course, he's pretty right to be, because he's done his job. We'll try my best, but it is Scyther and Aegis to deal with Snoot. Yes. As you mentioned, 2 more players in the Australian lineup, and this this best of 7 already looking a little bit different than what I expected. We'll see in a couple of seconds if the bearded Terran is going to come, or is it going to be Scyther, who's also Terran, but I don't know if he has a beard, so I will not say anything about that. I don't know if he's the Gimli Terran, maybe he's the Legolas Terran, I don't know.
Did we see a picture of him? I don't remember if he had a beard or not.
We've seen a picture of him, but I can't remember his face.
Should have remembered
so,
that.
So, Scyther. All right, Scyther is going to be the last one. So they will keep their best weapon just a little bit to the side. Aegis will come in if Scyther fails against Snoot. So TVZ though, so different matchup this time. Snoot will have to switch it up a little bit. Obviously, you don't want to play exactly the same in a different matchup, or else StarCraft 2 would be pretty boring. So what do we expect of Snoot?
Okay, so whether it was Aegis or Scyther, they both are Terrans. I was going to bring up the 3-Rex Reaper.
Yeah.
Because that's, you know, that's the game. That's the thing that everyone does. But what's interesting is I have not been casting many of the Australian guys lately. Like, only, honestly, I would have cast, like, Aegis anyways. Mm-hmm. But are they going 3-Rex Reaper? And I talked about this earlier. Yesterday, the Europeans are definitely going for 3-Rex Reaper.
Course.
And that was a problem for some of the teams dealing against the Terrans. But the Koreans, actually, they play, you know, a less dedicated style of Reapers. There's not Reapers at all. Mm-hmm. You know, sharing, I guess, like, the server, you know.
Yeah. Coast of the world. Not sharing some DNA, but sharing a server with the Korean players.
Yeah, I actually have no idea. I think if they get a good map for it, which is to say not a 4-player map. Echo. Okay, there we go. Then go for the 3-Rex Reaper for Scyther. Unless he's really confident in a macro game, which... some Terrans are. Actually, I think a lot of Terrans like TVZ, but no, I think go for the 3-Rex Reaper and try and just end it quick.
And actually, the only 3-Rex Reaper that I got to cast yesterday was on Echo. And as you can see, this is not that that big of a map. You can reach your opponent quite fast, and you've got some openings for Reapers, which makes it obviously a good map for that strategy. Well, this we'll see if Caesar decides to go for it, because once again, and that's the point we were making yesterday. If you're the underdog in a ZVT, you've got that strategy that you probably played a lot because you like 3 points on ladder like everybody else. So you do know that strategy, and you do know that you could like just outplay a slightly better player than you. So I'm guessing against Snoots seems like a good bet.
I think it's universally known that 3-Rex Reaper is a little BS, so you can like confidently say that instead of being politically correct anymore. But yeah, I absolutely agree. We shall see, though, as we get into this game. In the bottom right on Echo, as the red Zerg for Norway, he's Snoots.
The one and only two-time Nation Wars champion and all-around good guy. We don't know as much about this guy, but he is here representing Australia as the Blue Terran and going for a Reaper expand because that's late gas. It is Caesar.
Yep, Barracks not on that low ground to get that wall off already indicates that it's not a 3-Rex Reaper. I mean, I guess there's a couple of like other SimCity variations, but usually it goes.
Yeah,
in the
you
front.
Could do 1-Rex and 2, the second and third on the second red, but the timing of the gas is a little bit off if you want to go for a triple Rex Reaper. Usually go for a gas first with this. So this one looks like a Reaper expand. Then the question is, like, what kind of other strategy would you recommend to Caesar to because the reason we're saying that is that we don't think that a 2-1-1 would do the trick. Or Caesar is way better than we expected.
Well, exactly. Like, he could just be way better than we're expecting, but I don't know. The 2-1-1 seems to only do damage amongst like the top tier Terrans in the first place, which I don't think Scythe, like, you know, like, it's like not BM to say that Scythe there isn't, because I'm talking about like innovation beyond, you know, like those type of names. So generally a 2-1-1 without those names attached is just really an opener that's, you know, going to go into a bit more of like back and forth and just, you know, a longer game. And I have so much more faith in Snoot to do that, but it is going to be the 2-1-1. We'll see what Scyther can do. I guess I'm going to be changing between Scyther and Caesar, right?
It's okay.
What we can do with it. And I mean, Snoot, the only thing to say about Snoot right now is that he did prepare for the 3-Rex Reaper. I think he went for that spawning pool first, but that doesn't really throw you off that much. It's a lot safer. Didn't bother sending the two Lings out either, I suppose. Another note.
They are going through the map, and they will be reaching that CC in just a couple of seconds. So we'll see how fast he can react. Losing the first SCV would actually sting a lot.
It does.
And that that moron of an SCV actually went the wrong way and took a lot of damage, but will not be dying if the micro from Scyther is good enough. And that Reaper is going to save the day. I've got you, buddy. Get out, Zergling.
Well, okay. At least to save the SCV, but of course you still lost that time on the command center because the second SCV didn't come down to try and start it already. That's actually quite late. Only 75% done. Finally, I guess the super weak SCV goes back to do it. That's dangerous, but that works out.
And that other Zergling is not dead. Could come back and try to get something done,
totally,
but
could.
There's gonna be 3 Marines in a couple of seconds able to defend against that Zergling if he actually comes back. The steam is in the production tab, factory done, starport on the way, reactor will be there in a couple of seconds. The most standard opening of all time by Scyther, and now we get to see how good this guy is against Snoot, who obviously defended against that build millions of time. Didn't go for a Roach Warren yet in this game, so he didn't really scout and he didn't really see anything that could tell him that he actually saw the reactor. Okay, he's seen a lot. Yeah, so he knows that's a 2-1-1.
Yeah, the factory timing really tells you a lot. Also, the Marine count, if he had gotten a Ling in there, would have sold him as well. So he knows what he's anticipating. Exactly the first two drops. It's always the question of what does the third medevac, the fourth medevac do? And I have the same question, like how does this Terran player play? But Snoot should be fine defending. He doesn't actually go roaches all the time, although Snoot is like more of a roach player than some of the other Zergs, of course, out in the world. Not surprising to see him hold off on that and maybe even just go mutiling bling. He's pretty damn good with it. You know, I know it is Roach Snoot that's kind of comes together.
Yeah,
but he can do it.
That's what I anticipated from him too, considering this is a map that I feel like, for instance, Dark doesn't feel comfortable playing Mutalink Bane on. It's a map that he will go, obviously, for Roaches and Ravagers and probably Infestors. That's what he showed during IEM Gyeonggi, for instance, when he was playing against Terran. Not going to go for Mutalink Baneling, but in this game, Snoot will probably go down that route with the melee upgrade, or maybe he doesn't go for Mutas at all and just rushes for Ultralisk. That's not as good as it was before, thanks to the slight nerf to the Ultralisk, but that could be something that we see. He needs to drop down. Like, yeah, he realized. Yeah, that's not where I want my Marines, man.
Wait a second. All right, so this should be easy peasy for Snoot to hold. I mean, the Reaper can sometimes mess things up, but as long as the Queens are focused on the medevacs, this will be just a push off. Won't even be any of the creep tumors? So, nope.
Oh, nice mine from Caesar. Perfect positioning on this one. But actually losing a couple of Marines to the Queens, and there's too many Queens here. You need to go out. He's going to lose a medevac.
That was actually pretty disastrous, to be honest. Like, once your Lings are not going to be able to take on the Lings, you just leave. You just know that it's just not going to be worth it. So, that, you know, and then the Queens. Yeah, the Queens getting that snipe on the medevac. That was not at all what you want. That really feels like something that he's probably just, like, smacking his head right now for. Because this is a case where Snoot has offended against this a billion times. Caesar's probably done it a billion times, and only rarely does that happen.
Yeah, it's already a really terrible position for our Terran player, or a really great position for our Zerg player. Depends on the way you look at it, because 63 drones, a third hatch that hasn't been touched at all. That's the first time that some creep is actually going to get removed from the map. That's a cool scan. Like, he got a lot of tumors, but with 11 queens on the map, I think, and two more in the prediction tab, that's not like he needs some more energy. Look at this! 11 queens, like, oh, you destroyed this, so I guess I'm just going to use a little bit more of my APM and some energy to get that creep back on track. That's a really great position for Snoots. And, so do we see the Spire? I just don't know like if he's going to plant that down.
Yeah, Spire is still something that you don't see too often in this matchup from Snoots. Like, he is more likely to go in Festers or into those fast Ultras.
Yeah.
That's what I'm expecting, but I'm going to start your upgrades first and that Baneling speed. Those Queens on the front line, sometimes it's actually a really big deal that they are forced to place the Creep Tumors down, to be honest. But only if you save those 16 Marines in the beginning, because then that's 16 Marines plus two more Medivacs, and then the Queens need a chance to use energy, but this is not the snowball effect that the Terran wants, and in fact, just kind of like a complete stop. It's
like, when you go for that build, you're not going to go for that early third CC, and you're not going to go for those early upgrades. So basically, when the first drop ended, you've got a Terran that's got way less SCVs, not a third base in the way, whose upgrades are actually a little bit behind on the Zerg side of things, because he dropped those two EVOs super quick, Snoot, that is. So just in general, there's every single aspect of a game in TVZ which is really based on upgrades, to be honest. When you play Mutalink Baneling, or at least Baneling-based army against Marines, your upgrades are key, are pivotal. And in this game, he's just behind on every front. Now he gets harassed by those Zerglings, going to lose a couple more SCVs. 49 SCVs against 72 drones. Snoot is actually doing everything he wants. It just lost his fourth hatchery, but that's something that he can take, you know, like he's making so much money at the moment.
Yeah, instead of defending his fourth base, he got a couple SCV kills and delayed the third of the other, you know, his opponent. That's, whatever. So he's going to be able to take it now as his Lings have come back home. It shouldn't be was canceled again. That was nice by Seether, but we do have the Spire on the way too. So again, Snoot can go variations of styles and Festers only or up to those Ultras, but as I said, he is still very good with Muta Ling Bling, and it'll certainly help take care of these medevacs, but Meat Knight even need Mutas.
Okay, thank God he didn't have the vision for once, because that game is not going well for Seether, but if he did lose that double medevac with a lot of Marines inside, it would have been probably over. Those Marines can do something. They will stim and probably take out an infinity of Zerglings for a moment. You need to go back at the moment. And now he's going to have vision, though. Not so fast. That Overseer was there. He got lucky one time on this one. 4 HP on that medevac. So the double upgrades for Terran is actually going to be 2-1 on this side. Like, the one defense just finished, but at the same time, 2-2 for Zerg.
Yeah.
So that next engagement, defending that fourth hatchery is going to be so much more easy because of this upgrade disparity.
Yeah, the upgrades are going to be absolutely brutal. The amount of Mutas that Snoot can get to comfortably, too. not having to worry about letting the medevacs get away scot-free anymore, and just the fact that the Zerg player is up 20 supply, it's like actually usually not the case in Legacy of the Void, is not looking so hot. So Stute feels aggressive enough to go off of Kree to take this fight too. Oh, not a good sign for a Terran.
That mine could change anything. Ooh, okay, that was a nice detonation. Not that many Banelings died during this, but a lot of Zerglings did, and that's probably one of the reasons that Snoot just pulled back for a second, and he's gonna get a lot more Banelings. I feel like he has the upgrades, he has everything he needs, I think he has enough units to take the fight outside of creep, but he needs a proper engagement and maybe a little bit more Banelings. Cutting the reinforcement with the Mutas and Zerglings is actually kind of cute. Those Baneling detonations were kind of sick. That first mine going on the Zerglings and not the Banelings. Now intercepting with the Mutalisk. This is just perfect. Masterclass, say, ZVT from Snoot. GG. And just like this, Norway is back in that best of seven.
Yeah, they are.
Snoot doing his job.
Yeah, still kind of questioning the lack of a 3x Reaper on Echo, but maybe it was more like getting a test of what Snoot's doing at TVZ, since their last player for Australia would be another Terran.
Yeah.
It's going to be Aegis coming out, so I don't need the timer for that one. And I definitely think he'll have a stronger start than Sathur. Again, like he really, I bet him to himself, it's just like, oh, that started terribly, like, oh my god. So I guess Aegis is going to be a little bit better off. In the first couple minutes.
As you said, strategically speaking, I feel like he should have tried something different because, I get that you want to play like a proper normal macro game against a player with the caliber of Snoot, but also, like, this is Nation Wars. There's a lot of money on the line. You also want your team to do well, and I guess he would have had a little bit more more hopes, more chances to make it through against Snoot with, like, a different build, because playing the standard against somebody that he's legitimately better than you. Like, I guess Caesar thought that he had a shot. Like, he would have never done that strategy if he felt like he had 100% chances of losing. But seeing it from a different perspective, you're wondering if a different strategy wouldn't have been better. As you can see, Solo and Evire just lost to Probe, the Protoss from Australia, played amazingly well first game. Snoot making it a 2-2 again after two wins against Probe and Caesar. And now the two big dogs will play Aegis versus Snoot. This is going to be in a couple of minutes after this commercial break. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back, everyone. We are tied up 2-2 between Australia and Norway. So, great beginning from our Protoss player Probe from Australia, playing some really, really great games to open things with. 2-0, and then Snoot happened. Snoot did what we expected of Snoot. Now he goes against Aegis. That's the best match we could have ever hoped for.
It's what everyone is looking forward to, I think, between Norway and Australia. So it makes a lot of sense to be excited for this TVZ, which will be happening soon. Excuse me.
Okay.
So, as I was saying, like, you know, maybe they sent Caesar out a little bit early or to do that build, not a little bit earlier, but to do that build because they wanted to see what Snoot was doing in TVZ in macro sense, you know, not just throwing out three racks and then seeing, like, Snoot defend it. And, you know, you don't learn anything from that, I suppose. But I don't know. I guess it would be map dependent, too, because I know Snoot can play all different styles. So seeing one TVZ from Snoot does not say all TVZs.
Actually, you're making a really great point. Oh, actually, it's 56% against 44 in the prediction on Twitter. So this is really getting close. And the Aussies actually have the favors of the Twitter gods. So you can keep voting. You use the hashtag AUSWin or NorWin to show your support to either of those teams. So as you mentioned, we've seen that Mutaling Bane composition from Snoot, but now that I think about it, picture yourself as Snoot.
Okay.
First of all, it feels good, man.
Because Snoot
is a handsome guy, and he's also a really cool guy. But he defends a 2-1-1, like, super easily. I think he believes that if he defends this that well, he will shrek everybody, no matter which strategy he will use. Maynard, upright and early to support the boys in Nation Wars SC2. Go Scyther, Australia win, obviously. Good to know that Maynard is obviously watching with a little cup of coffee. I hope your knee is doing better, mate.
Oh, yeah.
I miss you already. So what I was saying is 2-1-1, you defend this with only Zerglings and Queen. you feel great, right?
Yeah.
And I believe that if you're a guy like Snoot, you could do anything after that. Like, considering how ahead he was after that early opening, maybe you throw a random random spire and you play Mutas, even though that's not your style at all, right?
Okay.
You could hide anything after that. Like, I feel like a guy like Snoot, if he holds on to a strategy like a 2-1-1 that well, like, he didn't lose a single drone, didn't lose a queen, didn't lose creep, and had already a third hatchery going down. So, I mean, if you feel confident in your own skill, you're like, okay, I'm going to play, I don't know, like fast ultra, even though I didn't do it for 6 months, or I'm going to play Mutiling Bane, even though I'm not playing this strategy because I don't want to show anything, considering I'm going to be playing Aegis.
Right? Yeah.
Does that make sense to you? You can tell me that I'm saying random stuff.
I get
I'm
your
not
going to
be offended.
Like, you know, I think I could see that happening too, especially if it's on the different maps. So I think we still have like Whirlwind available, for instance.
Yeah.
Like, if he pushes that 2-1-1 back so easily, he could be like, well, I'm not going to go Spire here. Like, I actually just go in Invitation Pit and Fast Hive and just beat Aegis, where Aegis has definitely been complaining before against Ultras. This was months ago, back when every single Terran was complaining, but of course Aegis was kind of on the forefront too.
Those Ultras that didn't die, right? Like, there was something slightly weird with them. The fact that they couldn't die, like, literally.
They're a bit good. I mean, I think we can say that.
I mean,
right?
If you can land a nuke on them, maybe you could kill them then, but no. But, definitely the meta and the matchup probably changed a little bit ever since that patch, and we see a lot more Mutalisk, which actually makes me happy, because I feel they are one of the best units that there is in StarCraft, in the entire StarCraft history.
Well, I love Mutas. Like, I've always loved Muta play, whether it was in TVZ, or, of course, it was a lot of people's favorite matchups for a very long time.
Yeah.
Or if it was ZVZ, I loved the days of Mutaling versus Mutaling. That was the only thing to do, and everyone else hated it.
Oh, yeah.
That
I loved it, too.
Oh, okay, good.
I
yeah.
loved it, too.
Yeah, exactly.
I think it was sick. And Jadong was playing this style so
well
exactly.
back then. Jadong and Jadong versus Scarlet, like, both Muta masters.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, that was super cool. So, glad I wasn't alone entirely. But the point is, I think Mutas far more than roaches, especially. This is why I really don't like roaches nearly as much.
Yeah.
They can showcase the best player, basically. Like, not just like micro wise, although micro on Mutas is good, but it's more about being positional and knowing when to counterattack and when to stay home. But of course, I mean, the good Muta players will do all of that perfectly. And Snoot is good, but he's not, like, I would say, marked as a Muta player.
Yeah.
So that's why I was, you know, maybe slightly bit surprised he did it.
Yeah, he's been
game,
marked with a little bit of different strategy. I guess he was the Swamos master at some point.
Yeah, right.
He liked to build spores and spines, you know, but he has what it takes to do whatever the Zergrace has to offer.
Yeah.
And whatever he feels like is the best strategy at the moment, to the point that, especially during BlizzCon, I'm going to go back to that match, but I felt like he was a little bit stubborn, just going against Drogo. Frost, cross position, getting all the bases on the map. Like, maybe you should go Hive and build, like, I don't know, like something better than a tier 1.5 unit. And eventually just threw the game away a little bit. So he can do everything. And he also is a guy that reinvents himself every single patch.
Like, oh, yeah.
He was the Swamos guy, but then the Swamos got nerfed. It's not like nobody knew about Snoot anymore. You know, he's not a patch Zerg by any mean.
Like, right. Like,
he's a guy that can play anything. And if he needs to go back to the Muta play and he needs to be, you know, marked as a Muta player, he will do it if that's the best strategy.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I think there was a big fear for a lot of Zergs they would be marked as just patch Zergs. And some of them did fall into obscurity after they got patched away. But Snoot was not one of those guys. He actually, like, I mean, he worked on his micro, his macro, his positioning. And he just, like, is all constantly agreeing. Validating himself too, as you said, that makes such a good player and adapts to, you know, the last 6-7 years of StarCraft. So overall, a good player. I think we've remarked on Snoot quite a bit, though. Of course, we're ignoring our little
Aegis
friend here, the Australian guy.
I'm already out.
You can still win.
Oh, you can still win this
okay.
thing. I'm already out. So Australia doing a little bit better than what I anticipated, thanks to Pro. But now Aegis, macro monster Terran. That's what I feel about him. Like, probably TVP has some cheeses because as a proper Terran player, he hates Protosses. So he wants to win as soon as he can because, you know, when you're making Vikings or Ghosts, you're already losing. That's what they say. So probably in TVP, he could throw some cheese. But in TVZ, I feel he's the guy that will go triple CC, especially on a map like this. Like, Nuker Precinct is going to be our map for this game 5. And I feel like Aegis is the guy who feels great when he has like 10 racks with lots of reactors and tech labs and will be able to produce like a huge amount of bio.
Well, I think Taryn's pretty comfortable at that point, yeah. Right? But, yeah, so Newkirk Precinct is going to be interesting for, well, two reasons. One, there is still a potential, of course, the 3x Reaper. This is a map that people go on it as well. There's almost no map that people don't, I guess, Whirlwind, basically. But also, if that's not the choice, if he doesn't feel comfortable doing that, then tank pushes into that third base, if the Zerg takes the pocket base, can actually be pretty brutal, too. So we'll see which one Aegis is going to go for as you load into this map. It's all tied up now in the bottom left. As the blue Terran, he is Aegis.
The Gimli Terran. Everybody knows about him, especially since that WCS cast, where he showed a lot of his personality. The French audience actually loved it. In the bottom right, he is the ace player for Norway. It is Snoot. And Aegis. Like, for instance, I mentioned Micro Monster, gonna go for CC first.
I like this. I really like it.
I think it's a really cool build in this map. Like, obviously, you've got a pretty large large map with long rush distances. But also, and I don't know that Snoot is a guy that will blind counter somebody. That's not really style. Like, I feel like he has so much confidence in his own skill, like in a macro game, that he will almost never flip a coin. Because that's what blind countering is. Like, if you've got, like, you can have as many games as you want, like, you can analyze somebody as long as you want, you can still get the wrong build. Like,
yeah, exactly.
If you blind counter, you can still get the wrong build. But the fact is, Aegis is actually going to play to his image. Just CC first into double racks, not going to go for the double gas. No, he's actually going to go for it. If he drops down a third CC in, like, maybe a minute and a half, like, I would say that Snoot would have, like, better chances of killing him just with a, you know, simple, like, Ling Bane Flood.
Oh,
like, you just can kill him. Like, we've seen it yesterday. I can't remember the players, to be honest, but on Whirlwind, we've seen a Ling Bane against a Ling Bane play against a player that went, like, straight 3 CC after a CC first. I guess it's a guy that picture as somebody who would go for that really fast third CC. So we'll see in a couple of moments, but
yeah.
I don't know. We'll see. I'm getting ahead of myself.
Yeah. So what's really cool about what Aegis did, you know, going for the CC first, is that he knew. So there is some knowledge gained from that last game, like I was talking about. He knew that Snoot was, as most Zergs are, paranoid of the 3x Reaper, and as such went for a pull first. A lot of Zergs are just kind of giving up on life and saying, well, I guess pull first it is then. So the two wings, funnily enough, you would think the command center first would be more susceptible to this. It's not. It actually makes the command center finish in time, so the two wings can't stall it out. It's even better against this strategy, so it was kind of you know, a blind counter, a hard counter is way too strong of a word, but it was a nice little trick for Aegis to get this little leg up in the early game. And of course, seeing those two lings, he knows he did it correctly. Like,
yeah,
okay,
exactly.
He went for the pull first.
3 minutes in, already slightly ahead because of that opening pull first against CC first, obviously. Defensive slash aggressive opening against something that is super, super economical, so obviously Aegis feeling great about it. And gonna go towards a variation of a 2-1-1, actually, with that double racks, double extractor. He gets a tech lab and a reactor. It's gonna be building a lot of marines, and gonna go for a drop. So no third CC, which is something that I like. Like, Aegis, I get that you anticipate the pull first, go for the CC first, but pushing it a little bit further away in terms of macro and taking a lot of risk while taking that third CC would have been super dangerous to me. So just getting that starport, double medivac, and putting a lot of pressure on Snoot, because once again, Snoot loves his queens, he's making a lot of them, and the creep side of TVZ is so important, so key.
Yep.
So you want to take a you want to be able to push that back a little bit.
Yeah, so he's going to be able to do that as soon as the medivacs are out. So of course, Snoot taking that top base as opposed to the pocket base. He's not the one that really wants to be in Aegis' face. He's more than a... I think he's more than prepared to, like, deal with the 2-1-1, but the tank pushes after is always a little bit questionable, even if they even do tank pushes. Sometimes they go for Widow Mines, of course, but that still remains to be seen from Aegis. We'll see what he does with his factory. He does have, I think, a tech lab getting onto it, but Snoot is adding on his evolution chambers. He is, of course, sticking with Lings, not going for Roaches in this game, but the question that we were talking about throughout the break, throughout the downtime, was does he go for the Mutas after? And I think it's going to be Aegis' question as well.
Yeah, Mutas are actually kind of decent on this map, to be honest, because you've got a lot of room to fly. from your main towards your opponent's main. Like a probable fourth base could be taken to the south of Iagus too. So this could be a base that could be easily threatened by Mutalisk. So we'll see if he decides to go for it. I'll go for more of a ultra rush or something like that with a fast hive. That double drop is going to come in obviously a little bit later than what you would get with a normal 2-1-1. Not that much actually. It's 520 already inside the map, and that's an amazing scan because look at the amount of creep tumors he was trying to go for. Like a full route straight down the Terran face, and this has been cancelled like instantly by Iaga's first scan. And he will try to get into a fight with those queens. I'm not sure that's a good idea. He needs to save that medivac. All right.
There's already so many queens. There's not that many transfuses, so trying to save them would be good. But I like that Stute almost, like, you know, kind of baited him to do that. Yeah. He had his lings behind the queens, and he was a little bit on the creep. But I guess playing a lot safer. Of course, he just witnessed his teammates dedicate way too hard, way too long. So I think he's a little more cautious here. Plus, but 2-1-1, it's always great to feel like beyond and win the game with the first team out. You're like, yes, I'm amazing. But, of course, more commonly, it's going to be the follow-ups that kill your opponent. So really, even if you don't want to kill the creep tumors, which would be a pretty bad opener to 2-1-1, it's still better if that follow-up still has those 16 Marines with 2 medivacs.
Okay, no 30 CC yet, so this is starting to look like a really aggressive play on 2 base. Probably going to plant down that 3rd CC while he pushes. But that's the moment, and now it makes a lot of sense that he's trying to play really cautious at the opposite side of the map. The Marines actually fighting a little bit against those Zerglings. He needs to have a foot on the map. He needs to be able, if he goes for that type of timing on 2 bases, your worst enemy, I guess, is creep. Like, it's something that will make you lose a lot of time, will help the Zerg with vision, with movement speed for his units. Like, everything connects with creep. And when you're going for a two-base push, your window of opportunity is actually super, super tiny. So you need to be able to take care of this creep and be as soon as possible in your opponent's face. And if he can get the tanks in the bottom right of our screen right there, if he can get the tanks to be set up here, he will actually control the ramp from the main base and the second base also. That could be a great position. And at the moment, Snoot doesn't know anything about it. He's not going forward with his queens. And those tanks will take this amazing position. And I'm liking what Iagus is trying to do right there.
I really like this position. There's 16 Banelings on the way, but Baneling speed is not quite done. He's still going to go for the break, though, and that's
Let's go.
Of tanks.
Oh, he needs to target down those Banelings. The tanks on the left side actually going to die, but the other part of the army, oh, he goes for a right click right there. He lost so much DPS on this phase of the fight. That's too bad for Iagus. This started to look so great for him, but losing those extra Marines actually made it a little bit more difficult. And now the production from Zerg with 4 hatchery is actually going to come in and going to come in super strong.
It's actually still very close. I agree, though, if he hadn't lost those extra like 8 Marines with extra medevac, he might have just simply won right here. The drones both look desperate, but there's still so many queens alive. They are able to clean everything up, and Iagus was pretty dedicated with this push. He didn't even start plus 1 armor. If this doesn't work, Snoot is in a fantastic position.
And I mentioned that he would probably plan down that 3rd CC while pushing, but he didn't do it. So we're talking about a Terran player who at the 8 and 32nd minute mark is actually not about to get a 3rd base. Like, his income is going to be super, super low against the 60 drones of Snoot. So this is a total all-in. He will go for it once again, and I guess that if he gets crushed right there, and I believe he will, that he will have to tap out. Like, how many queens does Snoot have?
Still like 10. Oh my god, 16.
16
oh my god.
Queens! Like, but it's also like a super good call from Snoot. The queens are going to be beefy, they all have transfusion, and this is really hard to take down those queens that will take care of that Liberator instantly, and now with the Baneling speed, Zombie.
That's going to be it for our Terran. I was so surprised I saw that the reactor was no longer on the starport, because one of the things I was going to bring up was that he didn't have medevacs, which at first thought was because of the Liberators, but no, just he couldn't make both at the same time.
Yeah, so he swapped the reactor from his starport to another rack to actually increase the amount of Marines that he had. But I mentioned like the super tiny window, and like I didn't think that would be so tiny, but I felt like he had those 15 seconds to win the game, and he did do a move command at some point and lost about 8-10 Marines, and that probably changed the game for the worse for Iagus on this one.
Yeah. There is definitely, well, actually, we're going to see the same fight we're talking about here.
No, that's the last one. Like, close your eyes, Terrence. close your eyes.
This is the winning move, this is like so.
When you've got 18 Marines and the guy has 19 Queens and 20 Bailing with speed.
Yeah, exactly. But the fight before that, the one that you're talking about that was actually very close to winning, there's two things that went wrong, of course. One, the tanks did not focus fire immediately on the
Banelings. The first shot were on the Queens.
Yeah, exactly. And then, of course, that move command, that 8 Marines and 1 Medevac really could have potentially snowballed. He would have killed at least, I think, the Queens. And then the second attack maybe has a chance. But seriously, without those starport units, I actually didn't realize how few there were.
Yeah,
that was always a bit questionable.
I think he had about 3 medivacs probably. Like built 2 from his opening drop and then transitioned the reactor, so went for 1 medivac and then 1 liberator. So that's really the moment that the key is holding all those units alive, holding all those units together and keeping them alive. And when you do a move like this, if we are talking about a 15-minute macro game when on 4 base, okay, you lost 8 marines and a medivac, but when you're going for a two base all in, every single unit counts, and Marines do super well against Zerglings, right?
Yeah.
But if you start losing a pocket of them, 8 Marines instantly die, and then those 40 Zerglings that you would have been able to handle, suddenly you can't. And the moment that you lose your foot on your opponent's throat, then it's over, I guess.
Yeah, and that was just a really well-played game by Snoot in general, I suppose. Of course, his Mass Queen style is well-known to everyone, so he is the guy that's getting 16, not just 10. We're about to see the final player for Australia. I don't know.
You want to say Probe, right?
Yeah, I might say Probe, not Aegis. I mean, Aegis said that one map to really do that really strong push. I think he could do a macro game, too, on another map, mm-hmm. but don't get me wrong, but Probe actually looks really good against Snoot, so
I would say Probe. We'll see in 1 second who are they going to revive. Seether?
Well, that's not what I was expecting.
Alright, guys. You cheeky bugger.
okay.
I don't really know what's going on here. So, Probe did take 2 wins.
Yeah.
Seether took 0. Aegis is the most known player in the team and arguably probably the best. Internationally, he's the most well-known player. And they revive Seether.
Well, Aegis also had a very strong push and a very good game up until that push. It was the last second that killed him. One fight, that is. Whereas, the Seether game, he messed up from the get-go. So it's questionable. I hate to bring the guy down. He's probably really nervous right now, but it's questionable.
Apparently, are we actually playing Vanny? Okay, so they're anticipating, and that's actually a really good point that production is actually telling me right now. It is there's still some maps to go, right? So the first one is Vanny Research Station, but the last one would be Habitation Station, and apparently Probe doesn't feel comfortable at all going against a Zerg player on this map. But also, it could also end right there. I mean, having a shot at getting that 7 game, isn't it better than losing on a 6-1? I'm not saying Seether is obviously going to lose, but what he showed against Snoot was just a smaller caliber of a player.
It wasn't good. I mean, I'm sure, I guarantee he'll have a better drop 2-1-1 in this next game because he won't make the same mistake, but I just don't know about the macro game beyond that either. So It's super questionable what he can do.
Interesting strategy coming out from the Australian team, but that's not us to decide. They decided and they wanted Seether to be the last player, but we gotta introduce that guy who could be doing an all kill for Norway in the southern spot of Vanny Research Station. Is the Red Zerg, Snoot.
And in the top position for Australia, he is the Blue Terran, Seether.
Has the trust of its team.
Yeah.
Because he's the one getting revived, and he's going to go for a CC first, kind of like Aegis last game. We'll see if he does exactly the same follow-up, which was a second Raxan, a second Assimilator, a second Extractor, second Refinery. I did everything except the Terran one.
Huh.
The Refinery, second one is going to come in, but no second Rax.
Yeah, exactly. No second Rax. That's pretty quick double gas beyond that. So I feel this is definitely one of the older ways to play a CC first. So getting that quick tech up right off of the bat is certainly interesting. We talked about Pro being uncomfortable on this map. It's possible that Seether has a very good build on this map. He specifically was like, yes, Fanny, that's me. That's let's go. But I can't really imagine what it would be other than, honestly, like mech. Would you be quite the treat?
There's a lot of possibilities that could come in from that, right? CC first into double extractor, basically you're going to get a lot of tech. But the transition that you go for, you can still, like, could differ from one player to the other. Right now we see Reactor Factory, so it could be Hellion Banshee, could be Cyclone Hellion. That's something that could pop to mind. But also I was wondering, I know this is a map that a lot of players like to do some weird Hellbat timings in.
Oh, sometimes,
and
yeah.
It could be like it will obviously hit a little bit later than usual, but if it does throw down a starport right now, like, there was another building about to start for our Terran player. Second factory or second? Oh, starport.
I think he's waiting, yeah, for the factory to finish, so.
Starport.
Okay, so it's not going to be the double factory build, so I'm going to guess it's going to be Hellion Banshee, which is very old school, and it kind of came back into fashion recently, so it's not the most surprising thing to see, but it is still... a little surprising. I mean, basically, especially against someone like Snoot, who's going to have so many queens, you know, as long as he doesn't just completely fumble the detection aspect of it, then he should be fine. Hellions only have really one base to get into as well. There's not going to be the third and the natural they could possibly get into, since the ramp is so easily covered, again, by queens. It really just be the third base. And, well, Snoot is already...
back.
He's going to go into roaches. Like, he saw the Hellions come out, that reactor on the factory, and probably was aware of a potential Hellbat attack. Like, one of the only reasons you go for Hellions nowadays. I actually really hate when this ends up being the Hellbat attack, because I think it's so expected when you see the reactor on the factory.
All right. The Hellbat attack will be the choice from Seether, but also going to get a super quick stim with this, because he did leave the tech lab to the barracks. So the stim is going to come in. What kind of units do we have at the moment? He's going to go for a first poke with a Hellion drop.
You know, yeah, he didn't actually... I mean, I Stu's got to start building roaches, right? Like, why just get the roach run at that time and then just be like, I'll make drones. Like, this is no... it's a little bit scary. So the armory is about to finish up here, but it is going to be the Hellion drop first.
Let's see the vision of Snoot. How fast does he see this coming? And how fast does he react? The drop is about to hit the natural, and there's not that many units there. Only 5 Zerglings going to transform into Hellbats right into the natural. The micro from Snoot should be enough to save all those drones, but I don't like the positioning there. Actually stuck next to a wall, and they need to go out a little bit. No roaches in the production tab. It feels like he can defend this with queens and Zerglings, but at the moment, a queen getting roasted. Maybe a second one should come, and then some drones to the back. Actually, not gonna get any economy whatsoever. One drone. I think 1 drone, 2 drones, maybe.
That was very interesting. So I'm quite surprised that Snoot didn't react with roaches, because I think it's just like the automatic reaction to Hellbats. But, like, on the same time, kudos to him for not doing that. He knew he could defend with the queens and a limited number of lings. But I'm really more confused about Seether's decision making right there to go for the drop and the natural. I mean, that usually doesn't really snowball enough, you know. Like, it really is usually about the attack at the front, which in this case is the third base, and then you rally the other Hellions forward, and then you have another medevac with the Marines come forward. But it was all disjointed, so I don't know if that was that. I really only would have snowballed on the greediest Zergs.
I'm also, like, wondering if you should have just kept the Hellions in Hellion mode, because that's the thing that I'm saying to myself like all the time. Like, when you see the drop, you don't really know what's inside. You can anticipate that those are Hellions, but it could have been mines too. But those are Hellions. The moment he drops them, he doesn't know about it, but there's not that many units to actually defend for those Hellions. But the fact that he waited, transformed into a Hellbat, then the queens are here, and not a single drone comes out. If you drop the 4 Hellions, you go straight to the mineral line. You can get those 5, 6, 7 drones that could actually put you in a pretty decent pot. Like, that drop didn't do anything. He didn't lose the medivac, hopefully. Thankfully, but he did... he didn't do anything with it. Like, he just killed a couple of Zerglings and a couple of queens, which is not that bad, not that big of a deal, considering how many queens Snoot builds all the time in ZVT.
Yeah. it's not that big of a deal considering what follows it up, which is not a lot. As we can see right now, it is just another Hellbat drop, which at most is going to get a mineral line. That's something that Snoot could actually replace at this point. As soon as he defended against it, and because he defended against it so well, you know, such like a light amount of units, he got the 70 drones, he got the four bases, he had his second evolution chamber start as well, which was missing for some time, but it does start, so his upgrades are still on point with Caesar's. I mean, we're painting a very grim picture for our Terran player when really, like, technically a lot has happened, but his opener, I think, at this point, you could call a failure, just, like, straight up. And it's more about, well, what are you going to do with the follow-up? Like, his third CC came down fine, perfect. Like, it wasn't harassed or anything, so that's, you know, to his credit.
Yeah.
He got double engineering by this game, too, yeah. So again, to his credit, not far behind in the upgrades.
Actually, a little bit ahead, I would say, right?
Yeah, a little bit. So that's a plus one melee was
because
behind.
Because, obviously, like, the Hellbat timing made Snoots think about, like, dropping those Evo Chambers maybe a little bit later. So in this game, in terms of upgrades, doing pretty well. The creep is still not too bad. Like, he needs to stop the creep moving forward right now, because that fourth base, if it's filled with creep and you can get like a tall surround from the right and the left side of this rock with a lot of creep, then it starts to be a little bit dicey for Terran player to actually make it work. Gonna drop one Hellbat before losing that medivac. Get one drone. Once again, not a favorable trade, but could have been worse, I guess, for Caesar. I'm receiving a lot of tweets telling me that Caesar is actually the best Australian guy, best Australian player at the moment, just had a bad first game. Mm. I'm down to actually believing you guys on this one. I'm just saying, in terms of how that best of seven shaped up, I expected Probe. We had the, you know, the explanation about the maps that didn't suit Probe for winning this entire show, this entire best of seven. Now, Caesar has an opportunity. He needs to push down that fourth base. He needs to get that fourth Crypt Tumor. Back. Can you get it?
That sucks.
All right.
Yeah, that is a lot of creep spread to go up against the fourth base. I mean, ideally, in most cases, again, it's a 2-1-1 against the basic Zerg build. You're able to pressure this base while it's still building, while the creep isn't there. So this late, you know, at 9 minutes, yeah, the creep's already there, and this is going to be a point where Snoot, again, he's been on 70 drones for some time. He's been at a comfortable armor supply, too. The only chance he had to mess this up was to get off of creep while defending, but that's no chance. The creep is perfectly fine.
Right, the 1-1 is actually over for both players. 2-2, about halfway done. That's a pretty nice free pack of Zerging. Yeah. That was really, really nice for Caesar. Can he make something out of it? Because, yeah, Snoot just gave away a lot of units while he was trying to transition into Mutaplay. So he wasn't messing around in the previous game against Caesar. He was just going for the kind of build order that he likes to go for in CVT. There's a lot of banelings, though. The baneling speed is done. Infestation pick coming in, so we will have a transition into late game. That drop could actually cancel that fourth hatchery, that fifth hatchery on the gold. But that fight is pivotal. Like, if he's not achieving anything with this fight, I see a pretty bad future for Caesar in this game.
Stugo with the infestation pit this quickly is a little bit surprising. He hasn't really, like, won a fight and pushed Caesar back entirely yet. It's like he knew the army was on the edge of his creep, but I guess he felt safe enough with the amount of creep that he had and the amount of bank that he has, too. It just is it's always a little, like, scary. You know, I don't think he'd be reaching towards that hive quite yet, as he sees the army now aggressively pushing forward, again, clearing up even more creep, starting to take out his queens, too. Only thing that Caesar's missing right here is probably a drop to the right side, which I guess was just cleaned up with the natural, but more
still
to
living. Still living for a bit, and actually a lot of units have been used to defend that drop. Is Caesar going to try to achieve something with that army movement from Snoot? No, taking his sweet time. Actually, gonna give some time to Snoot to finish up the plus two melee, because he only has one and two right there. One melee and two carapace. And for now, actually gonna go for a little bit more damage. Some drones dying because of a couple of marines to the left side. There's still a lot of banings, though.
Yeah. I don't really know if Snoot has enough of an army, though, to take this on. He's gonna go off of creep here in the wooden mines and maybe get some good connections. No, not so far.
Okay. Still going super far off creep, so maybe an opportunity for Caesar to do something, but there's just too much Zergling, too many Zerglings, too many Banelings. The reinforcements, though, those Mutalists are super exposed. The nice micro from the Australian player probably actually going to push back that Zerg. Here, Snoot has to pull back and make some more units. He's actually transitioning right now into a hive, but he needs more units. If he loses the fourth base, that could be critical for him.
Snoop got way too overconfident. If you don't have banelings on the backside and they have the reinforcements already in your face, then it actually might be a loss for the Zerg, which is what it's looking like right here.
Yes, either with the 154 supply against the 97 of Snoop, there's a lot of banelings, yes, but there's going to be a couple of Marines and Marauders just living through the day. And look at these reinforcements. There's a lot of barracks in Caesar's base, that's for sure. A lot of units streaming down the map, and he's going to get that fourth base. 15 more banelings, 30 Zerglings, but it will never be enough. Scan to the right. Okay, you've got a gold. I know what my next target is.
Yeah, but Caesar, of course, on his own fourth base, is actually looking super good in the macro department.
Oh, yeah.
Really impressed. He had those reinforcements on the front line. That was a pivotal moment, basically, in this game. Snoot, I think he really thought he was going to be able to defend. I mean, he was reaching towards that Hives that really told me he definitely thought he was going to be able to defend, but then he's so overreached. Didn't expect the reinforcements to come so quickly. Burrowed Banelings will not save him this time.
Yeah, the nice maneuver, trying to go for that Baneling bomb. Snoot, that is, but there is just too much Terran right there. Marines, Marauders streaming in. The 2-2 timing push will kill our Snoot right there, and this is going to be a seventh game. We'll go to the ace match, and I'm sorry, guys, we didn't believe in Caesar. Yeah. The beginning of the game actually gave us some thoughts, because that wasn't a really great opening, but in the end, just made it work. Great macro, pretty good splits, and a little bit of overconfidence, a little bit from Snoot.
Snoot, I would definitely probably say so. Like, agreed. Like, the opener, I still, like, it wasn't that great. The Hellbats died, didn't do too much. The reinforcements died, too. You only say the medevac, which is kind of like the bare minimum of what you can do. And Snoot was just getting such a powerful economy. Five bases, one of them a gold. And he thought he was in a super good position, because technically he was. But Caesar did not slack on the macro, so that's really, I think, where Snoot was underestimating him.
Yeah, we'll see a couple of moves from this game, lots of Banelings crashing through, but yeah, that's the kind of thing that happens in TVZ. You've got a couple of Marines just living through the day, and those two Marines, if they don't have any real oppositions, like a couple of Marines when you've got that many medivacs in the air, it's just like, freebies for Marines with those kind of upgrades.
So yeah, exactly.
Just played it well. It's also a really great map for Vanny, that is. A really great map for the style that Caesar used, I guess. We see a lot of issues from Zerg player, because they have at some point to go outside of the creep. And if you don't have a really great advantage at this point, you might lose the game. And that's what happened. Like, he went a little bit too further away and got punished for it.
Yeah.
So, Norway. We revive Snoot. I believe there is no questions there.
I really think we do. Yep. I think Snoot can really evaluate that game as well and say, like, I know exactly what I went wrong. Like, yeah. I can do this again. 2-1.
And now we are getting it wrong again. No, it's Snoot. Okay. And sorry, once again, Australian guys, you were right. Caesar doing super well. So, Clash of Nations. This is game 7. And remember that this game actually will decide who will be facing Ukraine in the winner's match of this group America. Group USA, once again, was called because USA were the top seed from this group, and actually not doing that well considering their seed, losing 4-0 against Ukraine earlier today. Habitation Station will be game 7, and will be map 7, rather. And I think now it makes a little bit more sense. Like, Probe probably thought that he could get a win from Vanny, and maybe thought, like, I'm going to have to play Snoot again if I win. And then on Habitation Station, I'm not comfortable. Maybe too little of a map. Maybe the golds being a little bit of an issue for him. It's just, I believe for us, the surprise was reviving Caesar instead of Aegis, because we thought that Aegis was a better player than Caesar, but Caesar showed some amazing stuff, and I can't wait for him to actually play, like, in major tournaments.
Yeah, he was actually super good in that last game.
Yeah.
I think it's really, like, kudos to the Australian team in general, but also, like, to Caesar himself to be like, no, like, I'm not having an off day. This is my day still, like, and I'm going to come back with a vengeance. Like, I think that first game, if it goes to disaster like, for anyone else, they're just like, oh, well, I thought I was pretty good, but actually, I guess I'm not. Like, I don't want to play anymore. But nope, he came back, so.
See? Everybody is actually going on Twitter to tell us how wrong we were. So, Probe telling us, honestly, we just have belief in our ace, Caesar. Well, Makes a lot of sense. I will not disagree with you guys. He showed some great stuff in that game 6, way better than what he showed. Like that's the reason also we were looking at it as a surprise, because
yeah,
we don't know him as well as we know you guys, Aegis or Probe, and he didn't show anything great. He showed a player getting outclassed, trying to do a 2-1-1 and just getting destroyed based of it. And now he showed like a proper macro game, even though his opening didn't go so well. And kudos to him in general to just handle the pressure, because you're not having the greatest game one. Then you start your game two with a weird opening, doesn't do too well, but he still kept his confidence. And it was like, I'm positive that I can still win this game.
Yeah, I think the biggest difference between the two games, because technically, like, both didn't have great starts. I would definitely say the Echo game had a worse start, but still, like, they're like the beautiful starts that you would hope for, is that in the second game, he didn't, like, continue to commit units and get them killed, right? Like, the Echo game, he kept on throwing drops away and never had that one big push that looked very convincing on Vanny. We'll see if it's as convincing on Habitation Station.
And to the top right of the map, Norway's ace, this is Snoot, as the red Zerg.
And in the top left, they believed in him, and his team actually did really good choice here. The good choice. It is the blue Terran, Seether.
He's actually showed dominance over the Australian region for the last year, but not really competing in a lot of foreign tournament. Now that I think about it, I think I had that discussion with Maynard during IEM Gyeonggi, but I didn't remember it until he mentioned it. Actually, you told me that he wasn't going to a lot of foreign tournaments, but you did have trust in his skills. Well, it's showing, and we have that ace match, which is the best way to finish up this this best of seven. I mean, the first one looked super, super, super one-sided with a 1-0 for Ukraine. And I thought after Probe's performance that we could see the same thing, maybe getting out a victory over Snoot or something. No, it's going to be 4-3. Either way, either Australia or Norway will make it to the winner's match. But already a really, really great series, really enjoying it. And we'll see if Teaser can make some magic happen twice against Norway's ace, Snoot.
Well, now I have a lot more faith in him. He's going to go back to that standard 2-1-1 build, too. So, again, I said it before the last game. I think if he did the 2-1-1, it would be, like, way better than an Echo. That was, like, some nerves or just some I don't know what it was, but it was not, as you guys were telling us and as we witnessed last game, the usual for him. So you see a 2-1-1, I have a lot more faith that he's going to be able to provide, like, again, not like winning the game with 2-1-1, as it takes out the Lings here, actually, very nicely done. but that consistent pressure and then that follow-up that can sometimes kill a player, even a player like Snoot. A lot of Zergs, actually, to the best 2-1-1s in the world, have just been dying to the build. They've been defending, like, thousands of times before. Just dying to it recently.
Yeah, we'll see how good his micro will be and his army control this game. He needs to achieve a lot more than what he did on Echo. He did achieve something. He did achieve, like, him losing the game, because that's the thing with the 2-1-1. Like, if you go too far, if you lose your opening, because it doesn't look like it's that much, but investing that early in that into that double racks and that technology with a reactor on the starport actually uses a lot of resources. It's not like you can go, like, super hard on double upgrades and third CC after that. Like, you invested a lot to have that that small task force in the middle of the map, and if you're losing it, like, not achieving nothing is already kind of bad. But if you lose those units, as you mentioned, he kept throwing units away on Echo. He needs to avoid that as much as he can. On the opposite side of the map, Snoot just doing his normal thing, gonna go for that third hatchery to the bottom side, not getting the goal this time. 44 out of 44 supply, he needs to get that supply block out of the way. That is done right now. Middle of the league boost is gonna finish up, and we'll see what he decides to go for in this game. Will it be Roach Ravagers or Mutaling Bane?
Yeah. Please pause. Wow. DC Observer was so on point with the energy, like, catch. That was amazing. Way to go, Kevin. So he was, like, noting that the chance, or the Arbitrary was, like, the slightest bit late, and then we need to pause because Steve was, like, saying laggy. Amazing
works. Thank you so much, Kevin. I think you can follow him at I had it before. It's Mapu TV, I think.
Yeah, exactly.
Mapu TV.
Yep.
You guys got to go out there and follow that fine gentleman. So, a little bit of more tension before that seventh game can actually, you know, go and unfold, because for now, nothing happened, right?
Yeah.
Waiting for the 2-1-1, macroing up from both sides, no opening, like no cheesy, cheeky opening from either of those players. Just in general, what would you say, like, who's the favorite map, who's the favorite race on this map, like, for instance?
Oh, the map?
Yeah.
Huh, that's actually a good question. I know we had the stats, so, like, I could have been 100% right if I just paid attention to the damn map, but
That's what I was looking for. Like, I wanted you to see if you actually looked at the graphic. I didn't do it either. Like, I have no idea.
I actually want to say that Terran's pretty good. It's just a shorter map. They have that, like, that top path, too, that even if the... Well, anyone's, like, you know, suicidal to take the gold base against a Terran who has tanks. But even if they don't, it still provides, like, that nice little walkway. And then you go right to that third base. You still have that choke to utilize. I actually like it for Terran.
All right. Can I agree with you? But every time I think about Habitation Station, I've got a remembrance of Scarlet versus Bomber.
One of the greatest
game of all time, guys.
It was, yeah.
That was during a Red Bull Battlegrounds. What a great game.
Yeah, day 9 went over it, you know, in his day 9 dailies, and it was really, really good. And I went over it too. Like, I taught a class in StarCraft, and I was like, this is the game that I got to go over. It was one of the best games ever in StarCraft 2.
It was so good. Yeah. I remember casting it, like, it was 4 a.m. here, and we got literally crazy with Moment back then. Just, oh my god, the mutas are coming back. Oh, the Banning Trap. Oh my god. It was such a great game. And Sasha's reaction just after that, like, going to the casting desk, like, totally shocked, like, oh my god, what have I done? I actually won this game. I can't believe. It was such a great moment. Great moment of StarCraft history. And I hope we'll get to make new history and new memories about StarCraft with those Nation Wars 4 right now. 3-3 tied up against between Australia and Norway. Let's see if that second 2-1-1 will do a little bit better. So far, so good. Not losing that many Marines. But now, this is starting to look a little bit grim. And once again, losing the medevac, losing Marines. This is... Exactly. I guess it's a deja vu.
A little bit of deja vu. I think he did like a little bit better this time, though. He took more Lings on his way out before his army died. But I think we learned very early on with the first people, like, you know, going for 2-1-1, that losing the units is not worth, unless you literally kill all the queens,
exactly,
too. Anything other than that, you would rather have the follow-up push. So, I mean, again, painting a grim picture for this guy, but maybe he can actually make it work. Going to go for a drop of the main base. It's immediately scouted. Stuart very on point with his creep spread in his main base.
Yeah, this is something you got to take into account. Like, it's not because you're not going, you know, the wear of your opponent with your creep that not having creep in your main is okay. Like, you need to have those creep tumors because it will make your Zerglings go so much faster. Even the queens will be able to help. You can produce some spores thanks to that, like on the edge of your main. There's a lot of good stuff that comes in from creep in your main. Second eBay and the armory coming up to get those upgrades going. But this is literally the same game as we witnessed on Echo. Like, he lost a lot of units, there is earlier upgrades for Snoots, a lot of queens, which actually are super key to defending this kind of strategy. Like, queens do super well against Marines. Like, they don't really die to them. Like, when you've got such a huge amount, you've got energy to transfuse, and you will get the medivacs. And if your micro is not on point, if you're not beyond level, you will lose those medivacs because there's just too much damage output on those medivacs with a proper targeting from the Zerg player. So, just a little bit sad. Like, Caesar can do better. Right now, the 2-1-1, the second try on the 2-1-1 is not going better than first game.
Yeah, but if follow-up might go better, it really is
and
a lot of
And then two medivac dies full of units. Oh, my
exactly.
God.
It really is. It's, like, so close to being deja vu. I think Scyther is doing, like, better than the Echo game, but only slightly, so it still doesn't give me, you know, much hope. But his macro really shined last game,
yeah.
And I'm hoping that happens here, too. He takes the gold base with his CC. Of course, again, Snoot taking his gold base would have just been suicide against a Terran, so that fourth base down there, it was supposed to be harassed by a Liberator. That was some miscontrol there. And that's honestly disappointing, because if Scyther's going to be this type of Terran to try and do multi-pronged harassment, more like a thermal, you know, exactly, like, you want it actually working. You want the Liberator actually doing something, the drop's doing something, but so far they're just cleaning up creep, which is not really affecting Stoop too much because he has so many queens.
Whoa, getting one queen, probably going to get four. That's really cute. He actually anticipated the movement, and that Reaper still alive. Captain Reaper with 8 kills. First unit produced by Caesar at the beginning of this game. 9 kills now. That's a plus one Reaper. Fear me, boys. Feels like he's actually like leading that pack of Marines.
Right.
Getting those 4 queens, limiting the creep a little bit to the north side. He should invest in another scan, I guess, to get those four tumors. Those ones, because they're still expanding. So he could kill this. That would be super nice for him. Snoot at the opposite side. Yes, he did lose a couple of queens, but his macro is stellar. He's got 86 Jeez. Drones. Can we see the income? Just quickly. Please. Can you remove the income, please, super quickly? 3,700 resources mined. Yeah, the income advantage is disgusting for Snoot. He played an amazing game, and by defending all those drops in the early game, he's actually feeling super comfortable going to those 86 drones on 4 bases. He's got a lot of links, a lot of bane links. Will soon to be 2-2 on his Zerglings and Banes, and with all this creep, like, Your split will have to be like magnificent, and your mines will have to connect with something valuable.
Oh my god, that medevac.
The Reaper is here!
Oh, Hero Reaper! Is this gonna be the first to die?
Save it! Yes!
It's saved.
It's still here!
No, 9 kills! I don't think it lasts very much longer though, the medevacs are all gone. Bye-bye, Reaper. He did so much.
You didn't believe in this Reaper. I thought he would drop a mine in the air and get all those Mutalisks at the same time. Getting 2 Mutalisks out of this attack. Which is kind of cool, but not helping. Oh my god, look at the amount of units from Snoot.
Yeah, so I really think that Snoot, besides having this good start from the 2-1-1, also really evaluated that last game and fixed his mistakes. So,
yeah.
You know, last game he overdid off of creep. He also went to, I think, too fast of a hive.
Yeah.
He never really got maxed out on Mutal Lane Bling. I like this better, especially if he's going to try and be aggressive once again. Get that maxed out army, have a lot of bank to reinforce too. But, this is looking much better for Snoots,
yeah. But
Seether, maybe that macros are kicking in. He is on his way to fourth base now, and his upgrades aren't terrible, but it is still just, you know, 2-1 right now.
Yeah, he needs to make the difference with the 3-3 upgrades, because as you mentioned, with the later hive, the 3-3 upgrades are going to be super difficult to achieve as Zerg, so I guess his proper timing will be with his 3-3 upgrades, or at least 3-2, but now, losing a couple of SCVs to the Mutalisk harassment, just playing amazingly well here from Snoot,
yep. Going
for the attack in the main, defending at the same time the drop at the south side and getting some work done with those Mutalisks. So just giving a little bit of stuff for Caesar to do, and intercepting that medivac is also kind of cool from him. Just Snoot playing a really, really cool game, and ever since he got that advantage in the mid game because of that failed 2-1-1 attempt, he feels like he's so much more in control than the last game. Also producing way more banelings than last time. Look at this surround! 360 swarm of lings and banelings, and suddenly everything explodes from Caesar, and Australia looking kind of pale on this one, because I don't know if they can get that 7th game now, because 80 more supply for Snoot.
Yeah, that's really, really, really bad. I mean, Caesar, he stopped macroing for a little bit too, so he started getting like 1,000 minerals here. That's not too good looking. His fourth base finally on the way, but losing that much army now puts Snoot in a position that, of course, first of all, he was already comfortable enough getting to Hive because he was dominating the map. His fourth base was not under pressure like on Vanny, but he just took this amazing fight. Now he can get to Hive, Ultras, 3-3, Juno lands, or he could actually just kill Caesar. He could actually try and go for the attack, which is what he's going to poke and see if he can do.
Yeah, we'll see if he can hold that fourth base. That would be the end of our Terran player if he can't get that base to go running. He has to evacuate, loads up everything in the medevac, and will give that fourth base away along with 20 SCVs. So obviously not a good situation for Caesar. We'll use Stim once again and try to get those Mutalisks out of the way. Got 2 in the process and an Overseer, but at the same time opens up a pass to his gold. Snoot playing really, really well and super fast at the moment.
The drone hero is trying to be the Reaper hero. It's not going to work out too well. But yeah, it looks like Snoot is going to be overwhelming Caesar. Chris Caesar fighting to the last because he still ended to win it for his team. This is not the end of Australia. If Caesar loses here, they just go to the loser's bracket.
Yeah, and they will face against the United States of America, that didn't do too well in the opening match, losing 4-0 against Ukraine's Bly. And even though this has been a massacre for Zerglings, there is still 100 more supply from Snoot. Impeccable macro, 88 drones. First, the Ultralisk Cavern on the way, 3-3 upgrades. I would like to see the Adrenal Glance too for the Zerglings, because they actually rock right now. Like, they used to be pretty bad, the Adrenal Glance, and now, like, like Zerglings actually hits super strong with this upgrade these days. Really like it because a lot of players were actually kind of mad because in Brood War it used to give like 200% attack speed, I think, and it was so low, like super super low in StarCraft 2 at the beginning. So it upgraded it a little bit. So yeah, he's actually paying for it right now. It's a really costly upgrade, but also really really great when you play Mutiling Bane. Mutilis will come in. There's a couple of mines to the side, but there's just too much here. There is just way too much.
There's also no... okay, there's one of mine, my mistake. I was going to say there's not much splash available for Seether, which is usually what's going to let you hang on to a game for a long time, but not here, not now. This looks like game over. Medivac to a down. That is it.
GG! Snoot does it for Norway. Nice performance by the Norwegian Zerg. Just carrying his team, like literally carrying his team on his shoulder. Just doing a... You know, doing Norway proud, I guess, because he's been... Thank you, Aegis. Actually, it's super dramatic, but on the wrong side of the, you know, wrong side of the score right there, mates.
Yeah.
The Aussies will go to the losers match, but Seether definitely changed the way we looked at him, basically, because, well, that 360 was kind of sweet from Scoots.
Yeah, that was amazing. There's even some crease crit over here. Like, what was it doing all the way over there that helped some of the Banelings too? That was just overwhelming by Snoot. Really great game, and he fixed any of the mistakes he had on Vani and just... I don't know, like Seether, yeah, he was very impressive on Vani, but his 2-1-1, the, you know, bread and butter of Terran, funnily enough, is the one thing he seems to have that trouble with.
Well, 3-4. Nobody points this out, I know, but I got the numbers right, okay? Thank you, Aegis. You know, always making us laugh. That's actually a pretty good tweet in two parts and everything. Like, just perfect, just right. Aegis, sadly, didn't do too well in this best of seven, but Seether did probe, actually, really, really convinced me in his skill. But Snoot, proved to be just a little bit too much to handle for the Australian lineup. So... just great performance from Norway here. And Snoot just, he's used to carry his team in Nation Wars. He did it during Nation Wars 1, was kind of helped during Nation Wars 2 by the performance of his teammates. Obviously, once again, I want to say his name, but I can't remember for the life of me. Protoss, that used to be in the Norwegian team. Ah! Okay, it's okay. It's not, you probably don't know him too, don't, so not even going to talk about it. Considering this is just an opening match, we will not have an interview with the winning team, but we will get the two teams from the winners' match to actually talk a little bit before this game. So we'll have something to hear from Snoot and Bly again, because Bly is the Ukraine's captain. So we will know about their feelings going into this winners' match, and probably we'll be able to congratulate Snoot with his four kills in a row. Dropping one game to Seether, though, so four wins total, but not in a row. Snoot playing just great. Probe that was kind of decent. Don't forget to tweet at UKR win or not win. Mm-hmm. Who you think gonna take Ukraine or Norway? What would you say? Help the viewers a little bit.
I'm going to say Snoot tanks it too, so Norway.
Norway
wins. 4-3, maybe?
Okay. Well, we'll gather all the predictions from the caster, and obviously Roddy's prediction,
of course.
Today he's not being on his base day ever. This sums it up for this match. We will go into a quick commercial break. When we return, this is going to be the winner's match between Ukraine and Norway, so obviously don't go anywhere.